meeting to order on, not February 27th, on March 6th. So let me first bring up the first agenda. March 6th. Sorry about that. All right, so, we have approval of minutes, and then we'll go to community input, even though the agenda says something different. So we have a bunch of minutes to comment on. February 20th, which was a regular meeting attended by Mike and Jody. February 27th, which was a public hearing, SB 2, that was attended by Michael and Suzanne, and that followed by the regular meeting attended by Mike and Suzanne. And then the March 2nd workshop with, who's Krebs, is that what that was? John Krebs, okay, that was the workshop. So any comments on any of these minutes?
Not on the 40th, everything else.
Oh, right, okay, all right. I would just say for the public hearing in SB 2, I think Vern Crozier asked us to append his comments. Were they made?
No, he didn't make them available. I do not take short notes.
Oh, no, understood. I thought he was going to make them available.
No, if he did, I would certainly make them available.
All right, and that's, other than that, I'm fine with all of the minutes. Anyone else's too? So by consensus, all of those are now approved. Community input. All right, hearing none. Let's see, we have two department heads, one with a call a guest, a visitor. Tom, do you mind if we start with the...
Not at all.
Okay. We're ready to go if you want to.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Sean? I'd like to introduce you to our most recent applicant, Sean D. Pasquale.
Good evening.
Chair of the board in the middle, Suzanne Hewitt. To your right, Mike Polo. To your left, Jody Lavoy Times.
Nice to meet you.
Sean, if you would, why don't you tell the board a little bit about yourself? What got you at this point?
Well, I'm 24 years old, moved to New Hampshire in January of last year. I come from Brockton, Mass. I actually just completed the credits of my bachelor's degree in criminal justice from Southern New Hampshire University. Doing policing is something I wanted to do as young as I can remember. Actually, I think at the age of about 5. I've taken several different steps to get to where I am now. I took more of a unconventional approach, if you will, to getting where I am. I took a couple years off after high school and worked full-time as an EMT. Learned how to interact in emergency situations, interact with strangers, and just interact in different locations than I wasn't used to. In 2011, I went back to school, worked hard for 2 years, earned my associate's degree from Massasoit Community College in Brockton, at which point, upon successful completion, I transferred to Southern New Hampshire University. With a year left, I moved up here and got closer to school, started an internship program with the Dover Police Department, and kept work still doing EMS, also doing private security duty as well. While I was in Brockton, I actually organized a neighborhood crime watch under the direction of the Brockton Police Department, which saw success. A couple times we were able to actually help out and solve crimes that were going on. With the Dover Police, I've worked with at-risk youth at the Teen Center, which is just behind McConnell Center. Mm-hmm. Worked with at-risk youth, have gone to court diversions, got to see how first-time offenders can be handled in a community-based approach. I've also gone on ride-alongs to see how exactly police officers interact with the community and perform the day-to-day functions. I've also started volunteering a couple months ago with the Mounted Patrol Division of Police.
Now, you currently have 3 jobs,
right?
If you explain to the board what your 3 jobs are.
My most recent job was at American Ambulance Service in Somersworth. We provide 911 service to Summer Door, Kittery, and Elliott. I've been there since July and learned all kinds of experience. I also work at McCall and Hill Service in Dorchester, Mass. As a per diem employee, primarily doing inter-facility transfers, but that has helped me hone in on community skills and learning how to communicate effectively. I also serve at Newbridge on the Charles, which is a subsidy of Hebrew Senior Life in Denham, Mass. There I work as a security officer, also as a dispatcher and an EMT. There I've learned how to handle rapidly evolving situations. I've learned how to handle the elderly population and learn how a situation may not be exactly what it seems on the phone. Also, I've learned how to implement community-oriented services with the elderly population and the very young population as well.
You've had some interesting experiences, Sean.
Yes, I did.
What do you think is probably the biggest challenge with regard to policing nowadays in a town of this size?
Well, being a town of roughly 2,500 residents, I believe that the Robinson Police has a very unique opportunity to foster a strong community-oriented relationship with the town. Biggest challenge in not just specific to Robinson, but also doing community policing mm-hmm. in this size, is learning how to do the balance, if you will. From what I've learned and what I've observed, community policing is all about having a balance between being a friend, being an outlet in the community, being able to call people by their first name, and also being a police officer, being able to enforce the law.
Mm-hmm. Understood. Any questions?
Yeah, I wanted to ask you about your internship with Dover.
Yes, sir.
So, you tell us a little bit about your experience. I'm assuming it was a positive experience from the way you're describing it. What did you like about the work, and what didn't you like about police work?
Well, with the internship, I really enjoyed seeing police officers day to day, both in the positive aspects of the job and the harder aspects of the job, the harder calls. Rewarding experiences were dealing with the youth, getting some kids through high school, trying to get them to do their homework at the end of class.
Mm-hmm.
Keeping an eye on the ones who were either starting to get into a little bit of trouble and trying to steer them on the right path. And seeing kids go from being eighth grade, not wanting to do anything, from going to school and tired of it, to applying to school and getting into college.
Do you have any experience with what I would call more the monotony of police work?
What exactly do you mean?
Well, it's not all... A lot of downtime, maybe we call it. And I don't mean that in a negative way or pejorative way. It's just not a lot of glamorous work. I mean, there's a lot of paperwork. There's a lot of waiting, I think, at times, observing. Any experience with that?
I see.
You understand that it's not as exciting.
It's not a television.
You understand that. I know that. But if you had any experience with that when you were at Dover, or any other departments you may have observed, or maybe through your classes at Southern New Hampshire.
Yes. With regard to that, I've done that almost on what are called shift basis with the MLS as well.
Okay.
Yep. Sean, when you said you had credits to graduate, I didn't know whether you were just expressing it in a different way, but do you actually have your BS in criminal justice from Southern New Hampshire?
Yes, my credits were complete on February 28th.
All right, so you are degreed.
I am.
Okay, thank you.
And coming from Brockton, I'm familiar with the city, and that is a very busy city in police work. I have friends that live on Central Street, just south of the VA Center. So I know that area is very busy, and putting a community neighborhood watch together was being quite impressive in that area.
I live on my parents live in a rather quieter section of the neighborhood.
Yeah.
Of the city, if you will. But we started seeing a little uptick in what we would call this strange occurrences, things we knew weren't supposed to be there. After talking with the crime watch head, we learned there wasn't one in the city, in the neighborhood. Took it upon myself, based on my classes, to say, hey, you know what? Let's try it out. Maybe it'll work. And it was successful.
Do you have any questions of us?
What exactly are you guys looking for in your ideal police officer?
Well, that's a really good question. You know, we're a small town, we're a small force. And so, for me, when we get, I check with our fellow board members, somebody who fits in, somebody who cares about the town, somebody who understands that, you know, the population is from little kids to older residents and, you know, can help to either diffuse a situation that perhaps could get out of hand if you know, a more excitable hand, you know what I mean?
Yes.
So somebody who can manage, like Mike said, some of the more mundane issues, fit in with the current force, fit in with the town residents, but who also is able to deal with, you know, a situation that might develop. That we would require a steady hand and hope to have a steady hand. So, and we certainly, you know, we've been gone through this a couple of times now, so we will be very supportive of an officer who shows promise and integrity and interest and motivation. So we will have the support of the board in that sense. And,
well said.
There's anything else that... So we wish you well.
Thank you.
And I hope this, you know, we're just in the beginning of this process, I think. But so you certainly, the board does wish you well.
Okay, much you need me to lobby us to this.
Thank you.
Nice to meet you. Nice to meet you.
Thank you.
Well, he certainly shows some promise, and he's certainly been active in the police field, sort of, as a civilian. You know, his internship with Dover PD, as well as, you know, initiating the program down in Massachusetts. So, I mean,
and also as an EMT, when you have to deal with, you know, difficult situations.
And he's gotten his hands dirty, like, he's been in it.
He's seen some of the good, the bad, and the ugly already.
Right.
Yeah. So that's
as a security guard at the end as an EMT. Yeah.
Right. So maybe that gives more promise as well.
Yeah. Do we have any conversations with his supervisor over at Dover?
No, that's part of the continuing background. Yeah.
So what are the next steps? And what
at this point, I am going to ask the board to make a recommendation that we offer him a conditional offer of probationary employment. And it's a three-year contract, our standard three-year contract. And it indicates that we will hire him beginning April 30th, 2017. Academy starts May 1st, 2017. At a rate of $18.75 per hour while attending academy and $19.23 upon successful completion of the academy. The contract is good for 3 years. We've determined that the expenses incurred by the town of Rawlinsford, should you make it through the academy, and completely outfitted at $16,000, and from the first week, the first successful completion week of April 30, 2017, so much is deducted from that 16 balance until 3 years and then reaches zero. He still needs to complete the psychological examination, the physical agility test at the police academy, medical evaluation, field training program with the department, and polygraph examination.
Do we think we're early enough before the April, the academy that we won't fall into the problem?
I'm hoping so. I'm confident at this point.
Okay.
So.
All right. So, shall we have a motion then to put Mr. Gosper on?
What's it
about? DPASQUAL.
DASQUAL.
DASQUAL.
I move that we offer probationary employment to Sean DPASQUAL as an officer.
Second.
All right, any discussion? What was his first name?
Sean on. SHAWN.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. And this on the offer.
They can find another good candidate.
I'm sure what's that?
They can find another good candidate.
Okay.
And I just have one other item. It is a purchase order. This is anticipated expense. We have some folks that need to complete their TASER recertification. So Lieutenant needs to order 8 TASER cartridges at $249.77, and that will come out of our equipment line item of 280. And it's purchase order number 1128 to TASER.
I move purchase order number 1128 to TASER for 8 TASER cartridges for $249.77.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
That's all that I have for the board tonight. Anything from you?
The bids are coming in tomorrow at 11 for the exterior drain work, so we have two. We have two bids, I'm told.
So. Otherwise, third bid on the pump.
Pardon?
The pump.
We have two. We have two.
We have two.
We can't act on that at this point until after the. We see what our budget situation is like. So.
Have not heard back from Martel as yet on that item, so I'm anticipating at this point it's probably. He's not interested in doing so.
Okay. All right, I think we're good.
All right,
thank you.
Thank
you, Chief. Tom, you know, we
could
flip the coin. Chief
Rutherford.
You're already here for
it.
All right. Thank you,
Chief. You know me, I don't care. You're your time.
Hi. How may I help you?
I don't know. How may he help us, Caroline? What's on the agenda that we need to talk to him about?
There is a non-public session for a compliance issue.
Oh, yes. I had forgotten. So could you hang on and could we talk to the other department? I'm sorry. I should have looked ahead in my agenda.
Piece of business to take care of.
Update you on a couple of things. First story is going to be coming up, so we can move past these things.
Good grief.
I'm going to reconsider that, Tom.
No, there's only like
four.
Oh, okay, looks like more.
Four. All right. My first one is for. It's two-way communications. I think one of the last board meetings when I was up here, I talked about having to reprogram radios.
Yes.
Because South Berwick had changed their frequency. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, in the world in which we operate, we have to keep up with them. So every time one of the neighboring departments runs around and changes something, it reflects on the same thing that we have to do. But, I mean, it's a two-way street because it worked in our favor today because we have small structure fire in town and they came and helped. So the first one that I have here is purchase order 906, two-way communication, and it's for the reprogramming of all of our radios to South Berwick's frequency, 2 and 405.
I move purchase order number 906.
Just the invoice line.
For reprogramming of all fire radios for South Berwick frequency, 400 office.
Second.
Any discussion?
Was it Dover that we had to do this for recently? Or the county? Dover.
Yep.
Okay, so this doesn't undo what we did for Dover. This is just in addition to, or
this is like an entirely different situation.
Okay.
Because they jumped off their police frequency, and the fire kind of, they used to all operate on one, and then kind of fire slid off to their own, so we have to be able to talk.
So this doesn't undo something we've done, or make, what, something we've already done?
No.
Okay, just in addition to?
In addition to, kind of.
We added a jail.
Yes. Yeah, there's other changes coming down the road for that, too.
Terrific.
Yeah.
Any other questions? All right, I'll call it. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
You know, sidebar with that, since you've asked about Dover, Dover is in the process of doing almost $1 million upgrade to their communication system. Maybe I just discussed this before. That's coming down the road, should happen sometime at the end of the year, and they're going to a digital setup. So what that's gonna happen with us is the pagers that we use, the smaller ones that most of us carry on their belts, are gonna be operable. So we have a couple different options that we're pursuing, so we can be ahead of the curve when that time comes. But again, they're changing, so it reflects back to us, and we have no choice but to make the best choice we can to be able to meet our obligations. A second purchase order that I have is, this is for parts and pieces. Back, we had that cold spell before all the snow that we just had. We had three or four different freeze-ups in the community. We had to go, you know, back to the water out of houses and secure stuff. And a couple of our pieces of equipment had some failure in parts, so we had to replace the parts to keep them up and running. Namely, our water bags, which is, you know, nothing more than a vacuum you carry on your back that sucks the water out. We had some failure in parts and pieces, so we had to order those. It's to American Airworks, it's number 905, it's $72 to cover the replacement parts we need to keep our equipment running.
Okay, move to accept purchase order 905 to American Airworks for replacement part for water backs for $72.81.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Next one I have is, every year we have to go through annual fit testing of our masks. It's a requirement that, you know, we have to meet. We had one of the, actually two girls, that they used to run with a medium-sized mask. They could not pass the fit test using medium masks. So we dropped down a size, small, they passed with that. So we had to purchase two small masks so that our members could be able to wear those when we have incidents. So, it's like everything else in the fire service, you know, nothing comes cheaply. Two masks, EV3000, which is the newest style, small for our new, for our two female members. Had to purchase two of those for fire tech and safety. Purchase order 908 to the tune of $731. Basically, one mask is about $360 a piece. So, cost of doing business more.
Let me see. Right, I'm the first order, number 908 to Fire Tech Safety of New England. Sorry, this could be, sorry, Mark. The numbers I can see. For two Scott 83,000.
It's not your writing.
SCBA mask for $738.
Okay.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
It doesn't get any better either, Michael.
The two medium-sized masks, are they still serviceable?
Yes.
Okay.
Yep. And so basically, because what happens?
Those individuals.
Yep. So what that happens is we have some other individuals that are looking to join, and now we have a spare mask or two to be able to outfit them and not have to go out and purchase anymore. And we have about four, I think, spare masks now that we can use. So we have a failure, well, we get parts and pieces to fix that. We have a backup now, whereas before it was kind of like, well, I guess I can't use you, or they borrow somebody else's mask. Prefer not to do that. A lot of fire departments will have a mask to an SCBA packet sitting on the fire truck, and it's always there. The best way to handle these situations is everybody should be issued their own mask. It's no different than when it comes to the turnout gear. It's measured and tailored to them. Same thing along the lines with the mask, and you soon let them have theirs. I don't want some guy that was, like I said, we had a small fire today, we get another call tonight, somebody puts that mask on, the guy's fighting the flu, now half the fire department's getting the flu. So.
Absolutely.
That's all part of the reason why we follow
understood.
That trend.
You need say nothing else.
Okay. Okay. And basically, you know, everything we hear, we've been, and I write on the thing where line item is coming out, so I know we have the budget part of it done yet. But this is all well within the working frame, what we do from year to year.
Well, this is also public safety, so, you know, but we're looking at some of the more discretionary spending items that, you know, until we have clarity on the budget, it's just best for us not to do that.
Yeah, and staying away from all that till we're done in a couple of Saturdays from now. The last one that I have is, we are required to do state and federal reporting when we do any of our incidents. State uses it to correlate all their information. On a national basis, they use it the same way to correlate, you know, all the information that Hellfire Department's dumping into these things so that they can set up grant money and whatever other funding they need to do. So every year we have an annual fee for our emergency reporting system. We upgraded it last year. Yeah, and that was like $1,800 because there was also a startup fee associated with that. And I remember explaining to you, not only do we have to do this incident reporting, which gets disseminated to all the proper points, but this new system also allows us to do a much better job of the tracking that we need to keep abreast of, like training hours, maintenance on the vehicles and the equipment. We log in all our fire permits. It's got just an unlimited amount of storage space and things that we can use for it. So it's been, we're using it now for over a year, and it's been great for what we need to do, and make it so much easier and efficient for all our personnel to do it. It's, you know, it's right up to date. It constantly gets all the updates, so we're not chasing stuff. So I've got the invoice here for the annual package, annual dues, if we want to call it that. This comes out of our training line item is where I take this money. Because basically everybody in the department has a little bit of information that they have to put into these things, so it comes out of that line item. It's $1,188 to emergency reporting for our annual dues.
Can I do
that? Okay.
Is move to accept purchase order 9072 emergency reporting for a total of $1,188.
Second. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye. 907.
It's all the business that I have.
Okay.
As far as money's concerned. Just kind of, I can give you a little more update on fire engine stuff. We had that meeting last week on when we were going. I don't know if you got any more information back on your end, any of that stuff.
Well, I talked to, it's on the agenda, I was going to give an update, so it's appropriate, most appropriate to do it now. So I did talk to our program officer at DES about, you know, they want to have an end date at the end of September. And so she is now talking to EPA to see if they will accept the terms that I proposed, which is to, you know, we can manage the money piece before the end of September, but until we get the fire engine, we're not going to destroy the other one. And so can we extend the contract till I think I was suggesting the end of March. What do you listen to? So she's talking to EPA. She said, I would be happy to chat to EPA if you'd like me to talk to them about, you know, municipal schedules, governing schedules, you know, what this means to us, blah, blah, blah. But that's, we're still waiting.
Still going through this. Okay. On our side of things, we've had a couple more meetings with some of the manufacturers which we've talked to, and we've probably got it narrowed down, you know, again, after the 18th, and we know where we are, and I already kind of gave you the timeline that we were looking at on our end of it. We're about 90% sure which manufacturer we're going to go to. Danny Tofu's been kind of heading up a lot of, Captain Tofu's been heading up a lot of the firing specs and dealing with these guys. Just told me this evening when he came in that a lot of these manufacturers, we have our base of what we want with the truck, but we wanted some other things, and it was always, well, to add on that, on that, on that, on. And of course, it puts us out of the limit on where we're looking at. But we got a quote back from these guys. Said, everything that you want is in this, and it comes well under the number that we're asking for anyway, without any add-on. So that's worked in our favor. But we've also talked to him. There may be a slight bump only because some of the price quotes that he gave us on things like the generator on the truck and the command light, which is like scene lighting, they may have a slight bump, but nothing that's really going to cause us an issue. But we talked to him about the timeline. and I told you before, 270 is kind of a workable one. They might be able to work with us and try to squeeze something closer our way. So that may help.
How close?
He wouldn't give me an answer until we commit to that. If this is where we go, everything works out after town meeting, and we finalize all the stuff, and whoever they want to do, and we award them the vehicle, then he's willing to do it. He didn't want to dangle that worm yet.
Mm-hmm.
But I told him our situation and where we were, how our grant and everything was set up, and he says, oh, I think we can work something, quote unquote.
Well, is there a chance that we could get it before the end of September? I mean, is that what he was trying to say?
I don't think he's kind of saying that much, or maybe he does. Maybe he comes back and tells me that. I think he's maybe thinking more on within this calendar,
mm-hmm.
rather than pinning him down to September.
All right, well, that's helpful to know. I mean, I can, again, I don't know exactly, I mean, I would love to be talking to EPA directly, just to be able to plead our own case, but we'll see what happens.
We're still, jumping through our hoops and getting to that point, so kind of understands where we want to be, but as far as, bid price and what we're asking, we're going to fit on that, so. And actually, the other thing that we've kind of, there's a gentleman up at the station now who does a lot of our repair work and stuff when it comes to lighting, like emergency lighting and whatnot on the fire truck. When engine 3 went out and got refurbed 7 years ago, it got a complete upgrade on its lighting package to the tune of like almost $14,000.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's just a light bar alone, it's $4,000. Well, I talked to this gentleman tonight, and he's going to be willing at a very minimal fee take all that lighting package from the old truck and switch it over to engine 1. So that would bring engine 1 up to above the standard what it's supposed to meet, because it does not need it now as far mm-hmm. as the lighting package that it has to have. So
that's helpful.
When 3 has to leave, we're finding ways to salvage every little bit out of it that we can. So,
like just an organ donation.
Yeah. In a roundabout way, I think you're correct. Mm-hmm. Yep.
All right. Well, we will be holding all the good thoughts about this, and hoping we can bring together the a yes on the bond warrant article, a yes on the grant from DES/EPA, and a successful loan application with the USDA.
Doing the best we can, right?
Doing the best we can. All right.
So that's all that I have. Any questions
here
for me?
Slide Jeff into. All right. I promise you'll be next.
No, that's quite all right.
How's the board doing?
Good.
All right.
How are you doing?
Getting there. So, purchase orders tonight. One's for Bobcatty, New Hampshire. It's 929. And that's for a new wiper motor and a wiper arm. The sum of $256.68.
A wiper motor?
Yep.
The Bobcat?
Yep.
How old's a Bobcat?
2012. Or 11. 11
and 12. Okay, so I guess I have to ask the question first. Move to accept purchase order 29 to Bobcat of New Hampshire for new wiper motor and wiper arm for the skid steer for $256.68.
So it's coming out of the equipment maintenance line.
Question?
Yeah, a wiper motor isn't something that normally needs to be replaced. What happened?
When the snow blowing, you have all the blowback of the snow.
Yeah.
And it accumulates on the window.
Yeah.
So the wiper motor's working extra hard to try and clear the snow off the window.
It's not just blood in the summer. Okay. Just curious.
All right. Any other questions or comments? I will call it then. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Next is purchase order 934 to Allied Equipment, and it's for a center pin for one of our plows. We had a structure on Boundary Street, and it sheared the pin. That's for the sum of $283.14. That's coming out of the vehicle maintenance, equipment maintenance line.
Purchase order number 934 to Allied Equipment for one center pin pivot for the American plow.
on the International for $283.14.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. So is the International back up and running?
It is. We took delivery of it Friday night at 4:30, and 3 hours later, we were up treating roads.
So the structure that was hit, is this one of the structures that's on the list to be replaced? Good to know.
Yeah. What happened is Mike was having trouble with his truck, so I was plowing his route, and, you know, his plow goes over it fine.
Right.
But my roads are different than his roads, the way my plow wears.
Sure, set up, yeah.
And I hit it and it snapped the pin. Purchase order 931 to Rochester Truck, and that's for the GMC Top Kick with the water pump that came apart for $1,966.06. And while the truck was at Rochester Truck, I had to replace a couple of the idler pulleys that were, had some issues, and a serpentine belt while everything was apart.
So that's all in here too?
That's, yeah, it's for the whole.
Move to accept purchase order 931 to Rochester Truck to replace water pump on 2008 GMC Top Kick for $1,966.06.
Second.
All righty, all those in favor say aye.
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 Now, do you have that back as well?
Yep. Yep.
We heard about the rough day.
Yeah, it wasn't a good week.
This is
Alexander's
very bad every day.
Yeah. And another purchase order, and it's for Andy's Cleaning. It's $11.47. And with that International, it went up for an exhaust leak, and the interior of the truck smells like exhaust now. The interior is actually black. So we're going to use an extractor to clean all the seats and the roof, because the roof has fabric on it, and against my back window.
Also,
it's all fabric. Oh, it's black. You take it in, it's like black as my sweatshirt. And it's for $125 to do one. Clean that.
This is quite worse. Purchase order number 1147. Andy's Cleaning. I see the red numbers there. To clean the upholstery in the International due to the exhaust leak for $125.
Second.
Any questions? All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
So last week, we talked about the backhoe and Chadwick Aross and me fighting the bill. Mm-hmm. Well, they pretty much told us we're going to eat the bill. They're not standing behind it anymore. It's out of warranty. It is what it is.
Okay.
So at this point in time, I talked to another municipality in the area, and I asked them, what do you do in an instance where you have multiple issues with a piece of equipment? It's a brand new piece. It has less than 600 hours on it. Mm-hmm. And it's all for the same electrical issue, hydraulic issue, mm-hmm. X, Y, and Z. So I had a pretty lengthy conversation with them, and they pretty much said that they contacted a legal department, and it's taken care of that way. I don't believe these bills are gonna stop. It's gonna be an ongoing problem. I actually talked to Chadwick Bayross, where they bought their pieces from that were taken care of, I guess. And I asked them, you know, all right, how about you take this machine back? Obviously, you know, one issue after another. And let's swap it out for something that's equal to this, maybe a loader. You know, it isn't going to be a brand new loader, but, you know, mm-hmm. something. And they pretty much said, we don't want your machine. So we have a bill from them for last time they came out when the transmission stopped working down a snowstorm for them to do checks and all their stuff that they do mm-hmm. for the sum of $585.48.
So we've already incurred this expense.
We've incurred it, yeah. I had to, the machine wouldn't move.
Yep. All right, so would you make sure that we address this after the March town meeting, the issue of legal?
So what I would do is kind of the way I was kind of, I wouldn't say told to do it, but suggested, is that the select board makes a phone call to Chadwick Bayross. Addresses their concerns and said, you know, pretty much if this problem is not taken care of, or problems that keep reoccurring, that we are going to seek our legal department.
Understood, but before we have that conversation though, the board needs to have talked about it to make sure that we are willing to go to legal, otherwise
yes.
It's an empty threat, yep. Which doesn't mean anything. So the board will have to talk about this and see about this. So if you could sort of, you know, make sure this remains, you know, front and center for us.
Yeah, you can put it right on the agenda and keep okay. It up there so it stays.
Yeah. Okay.
What are the terms of 30 days?
I think a copy of the actual invoice is on there. But as of right now, like I said, last meeting, we're in the high 20s worth of warranty work done to this machine already. And like I said, it's got less than 600 hours.
I don't want to pay him.
Yeah, okay, we're going to hold on.
We don't have to pay him for 30 days, and it was issued on the 27th of February, so I'd say we just hold on to it.
Okay.
And we'll...
Okay. So we'll keep this
talk to Steve after a town meeting.
Yeah. All right. Highway shed roof, we've gotten one time of material quote. Has anything else
come? I slipped off my agenda. I actually made phone calls today, and I have people coming this week.
The Founder Street water discharge, I think we've asked Caroline to issue a letter. The trenching permit is just there. I think we're going to sign something tonight. Foundry, IDDE, we can talk about that another time. Winter damage on Locust Street. So this was Mr. Brunel who came in and said, and what was the...
I actually took pictures and sent them to the board.
It was in the right-of-way.
It was in the right-of-way, and the post that he said that we hit, we did not hit.
There's one brick loose at the top.
Which is like 5 feet up. Our wings are at 40 inches.
So, yes, Caroline?
I responded to the board's request about following up with regard to our ordinance for snow removal, so that you do have an email somewhere with the picture so that you can see for yourself the damage, and also the snippet from the ordinance that says that we're not liable for damage due to snow removal.
So we should at minimum write a response, right?
Mm-hmm.
All right, so, All right, I can take a stab at it later on this week, unless the board is...
Yeah, we should take a look at the photos, you know, it's right at the ditch line, wasn't it? It wasn't...
It's right, I mean, yeah, so you have the roadway, and then
okay.
The residence grass is planted right to the edge of the road. And, I mean, we may have went in 6 inches.
You can see where the
when we were trying to push back.
Okay. Well, thank you for following up on that. We appreciate it. And then I have one last item that says about Morton Park Tree.
You've noticed the blowdown?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, it'll be taken
on your radar.
Okay.
Yeah, one tree is down for your truck.
I know, right? The only the rest of them could have gone down.
All right.
Not at the monument.
Anything else that we need?
Yes. Well, the email about the DES and the landfill.
Sorry. Oh, is this the old landfill?
I don't think this is
necessarily Jeff's though. Okay. We'll talk about that. Hang on to this. And we'll take up your ministry.
Well, I'm throwing it back at Jeff.
Yeah.
I don't think that one would be.
Step away from the problem.
Yes.
And then in the pile was for the transfer station improvements project.
Oh, is this already a governmental review?
So,
okay, that's also, our handle this administratively as well.
Yeah,
yeah.
It's here.
Oh, okay. Excellent. Is it positive?
It just says you got a copy.
All right. We'll talk about that when we get there.
Yeah.
I guess we're good?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Hopefully we'll be taking delivery of 550 this week.
Okay.
Something
good.
So we'll
hear that. Is the
sure.
bed was taken care of? The lift or anything?
I'll have to. So, the truck went to Wayne Chalouse to have the cab work done.
Right.
I met with our insurance adjuster there.
Mm-hmm.
I stated clearly that the truck will be going to two different places
mm-hmm.
to have work done. One would be HP Fairfield, which carries an airflow body. We have the same body put back on the truck.
Mm-hmm.
And he is going to do cab, the door, the fender, paint, and re-runner our truck.
Right.
He said, okay. I gave him the contact names up there and phone numbers.
Right.
I come back a week later, and the dent is banged out of the tub, which is the dump body of the truck, and they're prepping it for paint. I don't know who said what to where and who, but...
It wasn't what was supposed to happen.
It wasn't, so I guess...
Well, it wasn't what you were hoping it happened.
Right.
Yeah, it's not what I mean, we have a truck that's less than a year old, they got in an accident, not, you know, we weren't at fault in any way, shape, or form. I was hoping to have a new tub or dump body put on the truck, the truck's, you know, less than about a year old now. You know, and I don't want the reoccurring issues that we had with our last truck of the body not operating smoothly. So I guess what I'm going to have to do is when we take delivery of the truck, take the sander out of it. And, I mean, go over it with a fine-tooth comb, and if we're not happy, then...
They wouldn't take the sander out to do the work?
They weren't supposed to, so I brought it there because he had everything right then and there to bring it down, drop it off, and work right on it.
Gotcha.
So that I asked him, and he said, no, sander's not in the way, it's not going to bother us in any way, shape, or form. So I'm like, all right. So I was planning on taking the sander out, bringing it up to Fairfield, and they were going to put a new body on it. And they were going to reuse all of our LED lights and our warning lights that were on, because none of that was damaged.
Okay.
And next thing I know, that, like I said, they were banging the dent out of the body, trying to...
Did, if you don't mind, pass. Did, Primex, I remember which one's which. Did Primex contact us at all?
This was something that happened without an office-level conversation at all. It happened on the ground. So I had a conversation after the fact, once Jeff brought this to my attention, with... He had his interaction with an on-the-ground Primex representative who does assessments and takes pictures. But apparently doesn't make any, according to the office level guy, does not make any decisions.
Right.
So then I spoke with my contact at Primex, who was the claim representative, and brought this all to his attention, that we would have preferred a conversation and whatnot. And we're left now with, because the work has been completed and was already in process, he was not very able to... be very creative with an alternative, and basically told us that it is up to us to document it, go over it with a fine-tooth comb, document any issues that it may have now, but he said it's very unlikely that they would ever reopen the case for it. It does happen, but it's a very small chance, which is why it's really important right now, when he gets it back, to go over it thoroughly. There was one other thing I was going to say. Oh, he did also suggest that we take it to City of Dover, because they're the people who...
Yeah, I'll get a second opinion.
And get a second opinion, a documented second opinion about its functionality.
I mixed
it? Yes, okay. They suggested that.
Okay.
So they did all this body... They did all this body work with the sander in it?
Yeah, it got hit on the side. So the whole side of the so probably...
And the sander didn't get affected at all? Okay.
Sander was inside.
But they were able to do all the cab work with the sander in it, and not being able to lift.
The body lifts up and down.
With the sander?
Yeah. Yeah, it lifts up to a certain point before it hits the spinner in the back. It does lift up. Where we got hit is pretty much picture a pit maneuver from a police officer.
Yeah.
He hit us in the rear, spun us, and then the plow drove us right behind the cab of the truck. So where the dump lever is, on the body,
mm-hmm.
right there took like the brunt. So there's probably like a 3-foot area which was all caved in.
Okay.
Which, I mean, where it is, they do excellent metal work, body work. What he did is he heated it up and banged it out and reformed it, and, you know, because it's a nice thick metal that you can do that.
Well, in the best of all possible worlds, I mean, it will be fine, and right. We won't...
Yeah, I'm not happy with the aspect of how it all went down, and like I specifically
understood,
said...
Understood, but in the final analysis, though, it's the insurance adjusters...
Yes.
And the insurance company may have said this is what's going to happen. So while I know you're disappointed, I understand that, and it may have worked out this way anyway, we just don't know, that's what's so frustrating. You know, to not have had the opportunity to talk to, you know, someone who, you know, seemed to be more a decision maker.
Yeah, we were left out.
Yeah, it did seem that way, right? So, all right. I think we're good.
Is that it?
Yep, thank you.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So why are we doing this?
Move that we go to non-public session for the purpose of dealing with compliance issue with
personal
reputation
issues.
Second.
Roll call. Michael.
What kind of representation issues?
Reputation.
Reputation.
Michael?
Yes.
Jody?
Yes.
Suzanne, yes.
Okay, we're out.
I realized Caroline is sitting here not just to
hang out.
Not just another pretty face?
She probably has welfare.
Yes, I do.
Let's read into the public record. We did take a little segue when we were talking to Tom, and we reviewed the building permit from the Wentworth Greenhouses that is still under review. And the issue is whether or not we need to require an engineering stamp on the designs, which could be really quite expensive. So we are asking Tom to check into other municipalities, or not other municipalities, other greenhouse establishments either in New Hampshire or New England that have used these structures, which are manufactured in Ontario. So that's where, and that's pretty much that conversation. All right, so anything else then related to Tom?
All right, move that we go to non-public session for the purpose of the hearing of welfare petition.
Second.
Roll call, Michael?
Yes.
Suzanne?
Yes.
Sorry, Jody?
Yes.
Okay, sorry.
I'm not here with us.
It just happens, it happens. You were here with us.
We had that thing in the basement.
Once in a while.
What?
Let us know when you're ready.
I'm ready. Case number.
Okay, for case number 2015-007, the board is recommending $212.50 of rental assistance. And for case number 2017-001, the board is recommending $850 in rental assistance.
So I'll take that as a motion.
$850.
For rental assistance.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
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 Thank you, Caroline.
Good night.
Good night. You too. Caroline also presented us with this letter, so we will now attend to this in public. She's been working on reviewing the amount of sick days and vacation days that our employees have to make sure that everyone is in sync and everyone agrees with the number of days. So this is an improvement to our record keeping, and but it led us to understand that with our new policy, our new personnel policy, we're changing the vacation days accrued. Everybody's going to have their changes be effective January 1st, and we made the personnel policy addresses those new employees when they come on board to make that one-time adjustment to get them in sync on January. But we neglected to think about our current employees, and some of them were caught with an anniversary date that, you know, would have given them, you know, 6 months or more to wait for their for an increase that is due them. So the board is going to review one-time adjustments. Not to the sick, there is no issue with the sick leave, but to the vacation time. And this is in hours. And so this is all due to trying to adjust and get everybody to have their service date change occur on January 1st. So we'll take them one at a time, board, and I'll just, you know, look for a yes. And then we'll say, so for Andrea Cass, it is an adjustment of, we are adding 8 hours onto her
vacation. Is that, good with that? Okay.
So that's this. For Jonathan Uraskovich, it is 14 hours because of anniversary date issues, okay? And for William Hancock, it is 3 hours. Okay, and that's it. And otherwise, you know, these will be the new numbers then, and I will say that I will sign this. And these are the ones we just did. And the next thing that Caroline will do is to write a letter that the board will see for each staff person, for each employee, with both the vacation and the sick, but and then also sick leave payout, because that's the one that they're no longer accruing, so we need to make sure that they're clear on what they have as of, or what they had as of December 31st. Okay, very good. All right, so now we're ready to go on to town administration. All right, this is not, I think, I don't know if this made it to everybody's agenda, but you know, the board did not have the opportunity to talk about SB 2 as a board, nor the opportunity to either recommend or not recommend a petition warrant article that is appearing on the warrant. And I wrote a position paper that I sent along to the board this earlier today to look at so that we could discuss this and see whether or not we wanted to make this a board position. I did not print it, I'm really sorry.
Pull it up on my phone.
Yes.
Okay.
I'll pull it up as well. Yes, absolutely.
Sorry. You wrote it today?
I did.
I just looked at it.
11:58.
Thank you.
Yep.
Yep, there it is. Resolution.
I'm happy to read it out loud.
Well, first off, I thought we weren't taking a position on this, which we said in two meetings.
Well,
and then
we were,
you spoke with the newspaper as select board chair.
She asked me if I had positions on, if I wanted to answer these questions. I said I will only answer them knowing that these are not board positions. I was very clear on that. To be honest, I didn't read what appeared in the paper. It was absolutely clear. These are not board positions. The board so far has no taken a position on SB 2.
It did not say that. It just kept saying select board chair.
Well, I am a select board chair, so it's hard to sort of kind of separate that. But
so you're fine if I make a comment to Foster's?
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely.
And she'll write chair? I mean, she'll write select board?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yes.
And I thought we weren't going to take a position.
We didn't, the timing was such, well, the board never just chose not to take a position. What happened was the timing was such that we never had the opportunity talk about it such that it could get to the printer in time to either recommend or not recommend. We did last year because we had sufficient time. We didn't have it. However, I mean, personally, I feel very strongly about SB 2, and I hope you've read it. Did you read that?
I did read it.
Okay. So, and from a governance standpoint, I don't think that this is good governance. The deliberative session and what can happen in a deliberative session to change what it is that the vote put on in March is, you know, a difficult one. And as I pointed out, the deliberative session from the study that the Municipal Association has done, attendance at deliberative sessions is very light, from an average of like 2.4% to a median of 2%. So it's about, for us, that results in about 40 to 45 voters at a deliberative session. And those voters can effectuate our budget, the budget of warrant articles, so that the 700 people who come out to vote in March are looking at something that 40 to 40 whatever people may have changed. So And I gave an example. So you could, for this year, if the deliberative session had voted to do what the budget committee recommended, which is to reduce our budget by, what was it, 55,000? The voters would have had, the choice would have been a budget reduced by 55,000 or a budget reduced by 130,000. That's what we would have to live with. And from a governance point of view, that's a really difficult thing for a board to have to deal with, for a budget that's either six, you know, I wouldn't know what to recommend, a budget that's 65,000 less or 130,000 less. It's not a good choice to be in. Also, if you vote down the budget and you are then having to use the default budget, it's not, the default budget could be even less than the other budget. You have to reduce it by one-time expenses that were in the prior year's budget. You can't do, if you had things that you were hoping to do that were a new purpose, you can't do those. So for me, it's quite problematic. I know that when I first got on the board, I didn't have a strong opinion one way or the other, and it was Ed Jansen who, in talking with him about SB2, explained why he never favored SB2 as a process in the past. He's had a change of heart about some things recently, but certainly when he was on the board, he never supported SB2. And as I got experience in governance and in trying to work on budgets, et cetera, I can understand why he, and share why he thought it was not a good idea for a board to have to deal with. So that's my opinion, and I wrote that, but I wanted the board to talk about this and see if we wanted it to be a board position. So that's why I'm bringing this up.
Right, so the board couldn't take a position until after the public hearing either way. Well, I suppose you could have. It wouldn't have been appropriate, in my opinion. So to have a vote now is fine, but it's not going to make it on the ballot, obviously, because they've been submitted, they've been printed.
Right.
Or under the town report, because they've also been in the middle. They're being printed now,
correct.
Right?
Correct. So. The timing was... Right, the timing just didn't work for us to have had this conversation
right before.
I agree with that. But we could post it to the website, for example.
Mm-hmm. So when we recommend or we don't recommend a particular warrant article, just simply says not recommended by the select board.
Yes.
This is a bit lengthier than.
Yeah,
it
explains the position.
That recommendation.
Yeah.
So I mean,
not unlike the voting guide, which explains why we are in favor of the bond warrant articles.
The opinion.
Right.
And the like.
But this is your opinion. You didn't put
budget.
My pros in here.
No, exactly. No, I admittedly, this is, yes, but you need a resolution that either the board will accept or not accept, right?
I do not accept.
Or understand. So Michael, mm-hmm. I guess it's up to you to see whether you thought there was merit in this position.
There's merit in the position, most definitely. So I think that and have thought since Senate Bill 2 passed in 1994. When back in 1995, there was a mistake when municipalities were adopted, but that has changed. Opinion has only gotten worse. I think it's just a bit lengthy. I think we could probably cut it down a bit. That's all. It should be cut down a bit, I think. But I don't think it's wrong that the select board's recommendation be put out, because it should have been on the. Should have been on the warrant.
I mean, Jody, what is it about this position that you don't agree with?
Lots of things. You wrote it in your article. Your deliberative session literally hijacks, as your words, hijacks.
Has the possibility. Yes,
yeah.
It has the possibility.
Yes. If the 700 people or 800 people that make it to Tuesday's vote do not vote in favor of our budget. We did a poor job of getting that information out there.
No, they don't have a choice of voting for our budget. They would vote for the budget that the deliberative session was for. That's the point.
Yes, then that's fine. I think that our government works on checks and balances. That's why our budget, as much as I, you know, we fight here and go through the budget, well, not us, but we work and put a budget together very well. And we work very hard on our budget. And I also don't want anybody to touch that budget, but I also like a checks and balances. So if an elected official at the budget committee comes in with their ideas, I don't want anybody to hand anybody a blank check. I don't want anybody to give me a blank check and say, yep, great idea, keep going.
This is not the budget committee, so what we're talking about is the deliberative session, which could...
But there have been comments on both. So I feel that there is good reason for checks and balances. And I understand that there is a deliberative session. And if it's our job to get everybody to deliberative session, to yes or no, and then get our information out there on the ballot. So I see your point. I do.
Because it could not be our information that's on the ballot. That's the point that I'm trying to make, is that what ends up being on the ballot mm-hmm. could be something that neither the budget committee nor the board
mm-hmm.
are supportive of. And that a small number of people, because...
And you're still going to have your same small number of people at town meeting. Now,
it's
my
not
mother
as...
is in the hospital. She's not going to be able to vote on those things. I have a 99-year-old woman in town that is not able to leave her home. She's not going to be able to vote on those things. I have somebody that's in hospice, that is a town member, is not going to be able to vote on these things. You're taking away their vote.
No, that's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is that the vote that they have in March could be a vote that's different from...
You're
what
still
the...
taking away their vote if they don't get to vote on Tuesday. Well,
they can vote. There's a vote on Tuesday.
Are they going to be able to vote on Article 4?
Yes.
What's Article 4? Article 4 to 24 is at town meeting.
Oh, right.
First of all, town meeting is Tuesday, March 14th.
You know what I mean, Michael.
And it's recessed until Saturday. That's the business portion of town meeting.
Okay.
It's all one meeting, though. And whether or not someone can make it, physically can make it to the deliberative session, or they can make it to the second part of town meeting, is still a hardship. So I don't understand who's taking away anyone.
So when you're on the service, you're not allowed to vote in this town.
What's that?
When you're on the service, you are not allowed to vote in this town.
Of course you can. You can request an absentee ballot.
On 1-3.
For the ones that are on the ballot, yes.
I'll just repeat though, from a governance standpoint, if deliberative sessions, which have a much smaller percentage of folks in attendance than a town meeting, than a traditional town meeting, they can effectuate some changes to the ballots that have, and then those 700 people who come out to vote don't have that's it. You know, they don't have a choice. They can choose a budget that's 60,000 less than their elected people wanted, or 130,000 less.
Mm-hmm.
That's their choice. So, I you know, it's like almost like Sophie's choice. It's you know, warrant articles can be changed by a small number of people in a deliberative session. So, for example, if there doesn't look like there's anything controversial, and it's January, and the weather is lousy, and you know whatever, you know, a small number of very motivated people can come out and make some changes.
Mm-hmm.
And they just happen, and then wouldn't make any difference how many people came out on Tuesday if in fact their choices, the choice they've been given to vote for is something that they, is nothing like what they want.
And then if we have to do emergency expenditures, we have to do emergency expenditures. And we have to have meeting them. My point is that it's our job to get, I've been on both sides. I've put budgets together with you, I've been on the budget committee, I've been just a regular voter. I've gone again. We disagree on this.
Fair enough.
You do. And that's okay. That's why we're here.
Yes. Michael?
We have had traditional town meeting in this country for 400 years before we were a country. So I take exception to the fact that we're somehow limiting direct democracy when this is the basis for direct democracy.
Well, they also didn't allow men, women to vote either, so do we want to go back to that?
Yeah, I know, I've heard that BS that Vern spewed at us at the hearing. So I don't really want to sit through a repeat of that either. I don't need to be lectured about direct democracy, whether or not it's right for women to vote, or landowners to vote, or Roman Catholics to vote, or any of the rest of that crap that I sat through. I don't believe in SB2. It's fine that you do, but please don't throw at me whether or not veterans can vote, or people in the service can vote, or your mother that lives in the city of Manchester can vote in the town of Rollinsford. So, I don't need that, okay?
Let's try to...
But as a week, in a couple of weeks, she's going to be a resident in Rollinsford.
By town meeting?
By next year?
By next year, okay, well... If we adopt SB2, then I hope that she'll make it out to the polls and make it to deliberative session. I do. But I don't personally support it. And I don't need to be made to feel that somehow I'm opposed to direct democracy, which is what's been spewed for the last couple of weeks, and I don't appreciate it.
So
I also don't like, I think this is too lengthy. So, I mean, I think it should be pared down. I think it should be made known that the majority of the select board does not support Article 3, which would be the petition to propose SB2 change to the way this town government operates. I also think it's very curious that we never had to have SB2 on the town side for many decades, that all of a sudden there's a new board and all of a sudden we need to have SB2. Somehow the sky is falling in the town of Rollinsford. When this select board and the select board previous to that, which the three of us all served on, proposed budgets that were at close to zero increase. So for some reason, all of a sudden, now we need to have this. The whole point of SB2, when it was first brought forward, not by people in this town, but in the legislature, was to curb spending. It had nothing to do with increasing participation. That's why the caucus, Legislators for Limited Spending, was the caucus name, that proposed this crazy new system. That's what they brought forward, was the limited spending. It had nothing to do with increasing turnout or encouraging more people to vote. That's what it was all about, was curbing spending. And we do a very good job at controlling our budget as best as we can on the town side. On the school side, I understand why they wanted to go to that system. But it's very curious to me that all of a sudden now we need to have this. I don't think we do need to have it. I think this town operates just fine the way it has been. We try to do the best we can. We have, it's very interesting. I believe in the power of my convictions. I have no problem standing up at town meeting and saying what I believe. I have no problem with dueling cameras in this room, which will be used for different purposes, I'm sure, for what I'm saying. But I have no problem whatsoever having the intestinal fortitude to stand up and stand by the power of my convictions and speak at town meeting.
Yeah.
And for those that say, oh, they're being bullied,
they
are. These crazy signs I see around town because they're not... Anyone at town meeting can ask for a private vote.
And there are enough of them.
And there are enough of them.
Yeah.
Not every vote at town meeting is by voice. So if people are too timid to let their neighbors know how they feel, then they can ask for, a number of them can ask for a secret ballot and they can have it.
I think too, with regard to, I heard that there were signs that said things about bullying, which is unfortunate. You know, we really have a moderator who has a wonderful demeanor, very strong commitment to the process, and I think would be well able to manage the tenor of the meeting.
Right on the hill of my church.
So
the current moderator does a great
to
job
stop
with
the
that.
And I've tried my damnedest to stay out of this whole debate. And you know, it's people ask my opinion, I will tell them. I think it's a crazy idea to switch. You have your right to your opinion. You want to vote for it, vote for it. If you don't want it, don't vote for it. But I keep feeling like now all of a sudden I'm being back in
mine
the corner
just says,
because of my position somehow I'm destroying direct democracy. So
that's why I was happy where we didn't take a position on this.
We didn't take a position because the petition came in
on the very last day, and there was weather, there were people that weren't going to be here, there was scheduling issues. Had we had the public hearing before the town report was to be printed, then there would have been, just like there were, there was last year.
It was a timing issue, that's why we couldn't, you know, we were sort of stuck. But I think it's a, I feel strongly enough, and I feel it's a disservice to the voters for them not to know what their governing body, at least on a majority basis, thinks about this position. That's where I come from. It's, you know, just like we hear from the select boards throughout the state about Northern Pass. I mean, they feel strongly about an issue and are trying to get garners.
I mean, if we want to send out something, put something on the website that says, you know, in regards to, well, it's Article 3, right? The select, you know, there was an issue with scheduling, blah, blah, blah. We couldn't get it onto the, into the town report. The select board doesn't support, the majority of the select board doesn't support Article 3. I'm fine with it. I don't think we need to do it. This is, I think, too much to answer.
So just a simple paragraph to that effect?
Well, yes, a very brief paragraph is what I would say.
Should we write it now?
Sure. I mean, it should just be, to me, honestly, to me, it should just be as simple as,
by a 2-1 vote, the select board.
We will say that, we'll say that.
Which is what, it would not actually give the vote in the, town report, but I think it's very appropriate to put it here, it's fine with me. But it should be something simple, it shouldn't be, this is, I understand your frustration.
Do you agree with it?
Of course I agree with it, but that's not the point, I don't think.
No, it is the point for me, I mean, I wonder.
I don't think it's appropriate to have all of this, I just don't.
I just wondered whether the positions were, that you agree with.
Yes, I, but, you know, and.
It was well worded, like.
Thank you.
And if.
We can disagree, but I still like it, right?
You know, had Judy Curry called me, I don't know if I would have made comments, but I do think it's appropriate as individual members, if she called Jody, Jody certainly would have had the right to give her opinion. I think it's odd that Jody.
So much else.
Sorry, Judy, see the J's here, sorry, Judy didn't call you, I think that's a disservice that Foster's Daily Democrat performed, but, I don't pay her, I don't employ her, so, I mean, but I think it is, I don't think it's right that there wasn't that dissenting voice. But the board at that point had to take a position, but it was certainly appropriate for individuals to, I don't think I would have, but that doesn't mean it wasn't appropriate for you, or for you to have done it.
So, assuming that we do this, the select board voted at its meeting Monday, March 6th to voice its non-support for Article?
I would say something to the effect, but relative to Article 3 on the town warrant, the select board was unable, before the town report was printed, to take a formal position. A vote was taken on March 6th.
To render a recommendation or not on Article, what is it, Article
3
SB2, the SB2 petition warrant article, in time to meet the printer's deadline. Printer's ballot deadline. And ballot
deadline.
Time to meet deadlines. Hang on. Time to meet deadlines.
For printing.
Relative to printing the ballot and the annual report.
At its regularly scheduled meeting on.
At its meeting of Monday, March 6th, the board did vote to not recommend this article.
I'm assuming it's going to be 2-1.
Yeah.
To not recommend.
Monday, March 6th, the board voted 2-1.
I'm assuming we have taken a vote, but I'm assuming.
Yes, we'll assume that we've done that. We will do it, but let's get the, at its meeting in March, the board voted 2-1 to not recommend Article 3.
All right, the select board was unable to render a recommendation or not on Article 3, the SB 2 petition warrant article, in time to meet the deadlines relative to printing the ballot and the annual report. At its meeting Monday, March 6th, the board voted 2-1 to not recommend Article 3.
So shouldn't say anything more than that.
All right, so I'm gonna get rid of this for a second.
Shouldn't be,
Well, can I have a motion then to put this on our website?
Well, first, I think we should take a vote on whether or not to recommend Article 3, and then we can decide whether or not to put it on.
All right.
I would move that the select board not recommend Article 3.
I will second that. And I will call for a vote. I'll call a roll.
Roll call.
Michael?
Yes.
Jody?
No.
Suzanne, yes. Okay, so we don't support Article, the article in SB 2. So now are we?
Yes, I'll just keep on whatever.
All right, so we'll just put that on the website. Do we want to take another motion, or just, would you prefer that we move to put this on the website, or? All right, so I will do that.
I appreciate all the effort you put into this other.
That's all right, it clarifies my own thought process.
And I can appreciate that, I just don't think it's appropriate.
It clarifies it, yeah. So I appreciate the discussion, I think it's good for us to talk about this.
We still work well together.
Yes.
We can disagree, but we work well together.
It's a difficult issue.
Yeah.
It's a difficult issue that the legislature foisted upon us, the legislature, those many moons ago. So in any event, all right, I appreciate it, thank you. Shall we go on with our march through our agenda?
Absolutely, I'm gonna do something more fun.
All right, oh, good, let's talk about budget, that's all that's helpful. First I have to find my agenda, it's got lost it.
Can we go to records?
All right, well,
No, I'm kidding.
Actually, and this may not also not be on the printed agendas, but this is a fun, this is a good one. The board, all three of us, met with two members, two planners from the Stratford Regional Planning Commission this morning at 8:00 on transportation planning and economic development planning. And it was just a really, it's just so wonderful to be able to talk to people who have ideas, who can sort of listen to us. And I don't wanna, I'm happy to have the two of you have a little soapbox time if you wanted to, excuse me, say something about the meeting this morning.
It was very productive, and there's, we brought forward a number of ideas, things that we think we'd like to see happen, like in the village district, for instance, or traffic calming things on Portland Avenue. But how do we get them on certain lists, like the 10-year highway plan for the Portland Ave project, but economic development, what was it, James?
I think he pronounced it Verdeen.
Sure, James Verdeen, had some pretty good ideas and some funding mechanisms that we may not, we didn't know about. Whether or not we can make any of it work, we'll see, but it was interesting. One of his suggestions, I think it was a very good suggestion, was that we hold a public meeting here in town and ask residents and business owners, even if they're not residents, to come forward and have a conversation about what they'd like to see the future, the near future, the next 15 years or so of our town look like. So if people favor development in certain parts of the town, does that make sense? Is it plausible? Is it feasible? Are there things in the village, transportation needs, accessibility, like walking, sidewalks, those sort of things? You know, are there funds available to connect our community with other communities in a much more robust way? There hasn't been much of that, much at all, actually, in the form of economic development. So it's very exciting, actually. So I think this is the one thing, not the one thing, this is a thing that we, all three of us are enthusiastically in support of.
Oh, yeah. Well, it's, so
Yes, and I like the idea of the public hearing.
Pardon?
I like the idea of the public hearing to see what they have.
Yeah.
Because they also mentioned funding for the walking trails to fix those and connect those to Mount Farm. And
yeah.
So these walking trails down here.
So I really like that. So, So we were able, when we were talking to them, to sort of get a lot of the assets, particularly right around here, that are right in the village, which is what got us, you know, like energized, because, you know, there are trails in Scoutland Park, there's little parks here and there, there's a trail in the community garden, and so it was fun to, not fun, but interesting to hear, you know, have a receptive audience and look for ways that maybe we could try and move this forward, which is a lot more of what I would like to see a board do rather than, signing $50 purchase orders, you know, trying to, you know, apply some strategic planning to ways that we can make the town, you know, more engaged, more economically vital, and that sort of thing. But two things that, there are two deliverables that should go in the record. One is that the Portland Avenue calming traffic patterns is, I think that is going on the transportation plan. And he's also looking at the Somersworth Road intersection. Mm-hmm. And is also going to be checking on the bridge, the Old Mill Lane Bridge, as far as it's, whether it's on the state's bridge thing, we believe it is. And so there was that those deliverables with regard to transportation. Then with regard to economic development, they're going to try to broker conversations between this board and the South Berwick Council, board, whatever. Mm-hmm. And because, you know, and this is not a new observation, but, you know, there are a lot more things that we have in common with South Berwick than we do with, you know, larger municipalities. It's just that, you know, the having two different state governments makes it really difficult to think about resource sharing or those kinds of things. So it'd be interesting to have a conversation. So those are, you know, on the economic side and on the transportation side were two of the things that we could latch onto, and then the possibility of also doing an information session or a listening session. Mm. So that was a fun thing. That was really interesting.
It was exciting.
It was exciting, yes. So stay tuned, everybody. We'll see what the next step is.
Nice to plan, not worry where the money's coming from.
Yeah, so speaking about money, not knowing where it's coming from. All right, so budget, we already know about the budget, we don't have to go through that again. Child care at the town meeting. So, Salma, what?
We have two people who work at the school.
And their names are?
Okay, so we can start to advertise
yes.
That. Excellent.
And are we paying them?
I assume so.
Okay, I just wasn't sure.
Yeah,
wasn't
no,
email,
no.
So.
I also heard from Kate Lucas, the principal, that those groups, I haven't yet alerted those groups, if you see the rec committee in there, so that they're fine. She will try to have some extra tables available for them. I know that the garden club, we usually schlep our own tables and bring them in, but I think there could be some tables available too. So. All right, so that's working out okay. The bond warrant, I think I sent you email over the weekend, did I not?
I think so.
Okay, so I sent the bond council everything. I did get the minutes for the public hearing from Vern. So everything that we have to certify, assert, prove, whatever, through town meeting is all in place and in that folder. Then there's a whole bunch of other things that have to happen from town meeting forward, like the minutes and the votes and that sort of thing. So, but I think we're in good shape there. I haven't heard back from her, but I think we're in good shape, so we'll see if she confirms that. Recirculating pump quotes, that's just there to remind us that we need to attend to this as soon as we can. The last item is the Tuesday election in our presence. And again, how do we want to manage shifts or, you know, 7 to 7? I know
I'll be
Mr.
There,
Rollo,
I don't think it's appropriate that I be,
you can't.
Well, I usually do, so.
Right. So you can't.
Yeah, you'll be doing crowd control, like
exactly.
I actually have to do.
Yeah.
Maybe?
Fine by me.
No, what
Mike,
I
oh,
do.
Oh, Mike.
So,
yeah, so one of the two of us can.
So we'll be
yeah,
over at
Malahawk.
Yes. We'll be floating.
Yeah. Okay.
You can run the rec table if you don't mind.
So are we all planning to be here pretty much for the entire day?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Very good then.
Can I Kathy, one stipulation on
He can't be there.
Yeah, of course, yeah, absolutely.
If so be it, medically, if I can't be here, that's gonna be okay?
Yeah, it's unclear to us what our obligations are for municipal elections. It's clear for state and federal, but it's unclear for municipal. So we
Plan on being here all day?
Yeah, I think I'll feel fine as if there's at least one of us that's not on the ballot here, so I think we'll be able to arrange that, so. It's supposed to snow.
Seven?
Yeah, it's like long range, yeah. Okay, are we ready to move on?
Yeah.
All right, fire engine, did you catch everything that I said to Chief Rutherford, you noticed, okay, so we don't have to
My only question was, are we still scheduled a council vote this month?
Right now we are, March, yes. But the program officer is trying to see if we need to rework the agreement. So I don't know what that means.
Let's hope we get on this round, because what I've been reading in the papers, a lot of these direct aids to communities won't exist in this next year necessarily, so. Let's hope we get in this year.
Yeah. Okay, USDA loan application, it's sort of death by a thousand cuts. We did get them to accept the agreement that we signed with Royal Tanner. They wanted it in a different form, but they're accepting that, and they did accept, or Hoyle and Tanner blessed the fact that Caroline and Jeff and I would be managing the, so they pushed that along to USDA. I haven't heard anything back, and now there's a question about the budget. So I haven't pursued that. I don't know exactly what the issue is, but death by, no, I mean the budget of the culvert project, I think. So again, it's sort of death by a thousand cuts. Mm-hmm. All right, rec committee. So I reviewed, did you see my edits to the job descriptions?
I'm gonna say no.
Okay. So. They were plentiful.
Okay.
But most of them were, you know, the list of duties, mm-hmm. most of them I was just getting the construction parallel, yeah. you know, so that they were using the same form.
Okay.
There was in it, there were two job descriptions, though, for the director and the assistant director, where, you know, the summary at the top, it wasn't a summary of the job, it was a summary of something else. I don't remember even exactly what it was, so I noted that. And the thing that I think was probably most substantive was the camp counselor, because it said under general supervision. And normally for the lower paid jobs, it's under direct supervision. So it's directors that work under general supervision. And so I suggested that.
I think they cut and pasted from.
Yeah, well, understood. So I mean, I did a round of edits. So if somebody wanted to clean that up and bring them back or something, that would.
Did you send them to the rest of the rec department?
I have not seen them okay. come through.
I don't know who I sent them to.
I will.
I saw them. I think it was
Oh, it could have been just the board, Jody. Yeah, maybe I thought you would.
Take
yeah.
a look at them and then send them off.
Yeah,
via,
okay.
Jody, I thought.
So, I mean, they were either in Word with, you know, tracking on, so it's.
Yeah, there were some. Yeah. They cut and pasted some of it. Was
but I
did
but.
So,
but
they shouldn't be sending it to the Barrington Rec Director for the to apply for the job.
But my overarching comment is unbelievable work. I mean, to have job description is a wonderful, wonderful thing. So thanks to the
yeah.
committee for,
yes.
for doing this.
Yeah, and they made it into the paper. They did.
I saw that.
That's great. Article on them. So it was nice free advertising. Their registration forms are out. They're going to be going to. They can either come here and drop them off at my desk, and I'll get them to D, or they're just going to D, and she's keeping track of all that. She's co-chair. And then the next step is hiring as well, which we were just talking about.
Right. Oh, and the application too, you know, where you ask you for the Social Security number, I had a question about that.
Okay.
Because I don't know that we have to ask for it in the application. If we eventually hire them, when they fill out their payroll records, they'll need to provide a social security.
Okay.
But I think on the application, pardon?
And the background check, too.
Yes, but, you know, to have just everybody submit it before we actually hire them, I just...
And we keep them on file, or whoever keeps them on file for the liability.
It is, yeah, I mean, it's fine, you know. We've all had our consciousness raised, I think, on the aspects of social security, so. So anyway, job well done. We put work study in this agenda based on your recommendation, but we're not sure why. So what...
Yes, there's a work study form that we need to fill out for UNH. Sorry.
In order to...
To apply for the work...
So something the board has to do and the town has to do?
Yeah, it just needed our signature to send back to UNH.
Okay, so we don't have that?
Yeah, I do in my desk.
Okay, all right, so...
Do you want to do it at the end?
Yeah, when we do correspondence. Credit cards, when we roll them out, Jody, this is to get you up to speed. The highway department and the fire department, which are the two that we rolled out, they were unhappy with the $200 limit. So at some point, we'll have a conversation with them, but they're still under the $200 limit. The bid openings, this is for the exterior drainage at Town Hall. They're coming in tomorrow by 11. They have to be here. We've gotten two already. And so we're supposed to have a public opening at that time. I will be able to be here, so I can conduct that public opening. And of course, also...
I might be here depending on one of them in the morning.
Yep. Okay. So that's going on tomorrow. The assessing workshop. So this is just, we haven't really done a whole lot of publicity on it, but this is the an information session. It says workshop, but it's an information session for the public, for Avatar to talk about the revalue process and what it means to them. So we could start to do some publicity. The question is, should we have it here or at the school when we have it? It's a Wednesday, I think. Wednesday.
I don't think the school, if they want to be able to have any sort of... they have any kind of audio visual, right?
Well, we have a projector now.
Oh, yeah, but they have that smart board, right?
That is a nice thing to have. Yes.
You can fit more people in too. I would hope we have a lot more people than we could fit in here.
It is Wednesday the 12th of April. Yeah. So, does the school seem like a good place to hold it?
Do they will need that much space?
No, when we went to the one in...
Boy, we went to one in...
In Northwood, right?
It was crowded. It was packed.
Or Nottingham, rather. It was packed.
It was packed.
And it was a good-sized room.
Okay.
It was... I don't know if it was... It wasn't as large as the gym, but it was at least 3/4, I think, the size of that. I was shocked at how many people went to that. We went just because we... It was...
Well,
Caroline, who was what? Didn't you go to it, too? No. Yeah.
Maybe Jody wasn't on the board with
that. Was that an assessment?
It was, but
yeah. That we all went to.
Yeah, over Nottingham. You were there, weren't you?
I was in Northwood.
Well, that was it with a ton of people.
Yeah. It was packed in there.
It was an information session that the DRA was partly putting on. It was partly also, but it was because they were doing their reval, and there were issues with vacation homes, wherever this...
Oh,
was
the lake.
We were on the lakes of Nottingham. Yeah.
But didn't you feel like you had said that you didn't get much information on that?
We didn't, because we were going there
a
different purpose,
right.
We thought. If I were a resident of that town, I would have been a lot of work.
Right.
But we were thinking, the way it was built to us, remember?
Yeah.
Through the Municipal Association newsletter, that's why
it
went to
us.
Yeah, and it was.
So you're thinking that this would be lightly attended, is what?
I hope not.
I'm going to ask the general public. There isn't any of them here.
Okay.
But we can find out. So would you attend, or maybe I shouldn't ask you, because you attend everything. Where's that?
Public question.
Bad question, but what... So this is an information session that Avatar is going to host about the revale process, you know, what it might mean, neighborhoods that may be being, you know, they may apply some large, you know, increase or decrease or whatever it is. So it's just talking about those kinds of things. It seems to me that because this is how our taxes get get put together, that they would be interested in this. Am I wrong in thinking that? I am wrong in thinking that. Charlie, do you agree with that?
I don't know how many people you would actually get that would actually think about, oh, how do my taxes work? All they look at is how much my taxes went up, how much they're going down.
Well, if their house, if their assessed value in their house all of a sudden goes up $100,000, wouldn't they want to know that there may be an appeal process or a petition process or?
Is this going to happen after they get the assessment for this year?
No.
See, that's the problem.
Well, no, but it's going to tell them what the process is and what they can, when they can come in to talk about it. I mean, so Celia, what do you?
I think it depends on how well publicized you make it.
Yes. Clearly.
If you start getting the word out now and getting it, and the way you put it out there will determine how many people you get. Because there seems to be this year a group of people that are critical of each other and a lot of discussion going on about finances in the town, budget and stuff like that. So you might be able to pull in those people along with regular homeowners, but I'm not sure. I just say get it out now and start talking it up if you want people to be there.
Remember when we did the 10-year road plan, we thought everybody would come and there was like 7 people?
It's true.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, oh, this is so exciting, 10 years and...
It's true.
Mm-hmm.
I think the problem is going to be they're going to get their bill later and find out it's going up.
Yeah, we might.
And that's when they.
They're going to get their assessed value. They will get their assessed value in the summer.
Right.
Yeah, but
this comes before
this
what they're going
before.
To have. So they're not going to be interested because they're going to just figure.
That.
All right. So here.
Yeah.
Here.
You know, I mean, if it came after they get the assessment.
Unfortunate.
And you can always have it here, and if it turns out to be a bigger group that you can hold, you can reschedule for another day at a second
session.
Well,
have a second session, probably.
Yeah.
Okay, we'll do it here.
But I know some of my neighbors would never come out for anything.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Ditto.
Believe
Mine
me,
too.
I've been knocking on doors in the
right.
past.
Okay. Well, all right. Okay, so let's march through. So legal, this has to do with the compliance issue that we went into non-public
mm-hmm.
to talk about. So we have asked our building inspector to do some assessing to evaluate a particular issue for us. And this was just to make sure that we could talk about this in public and agree to it in public. So.
Mm-hmm.
That will be going on. Building permit refund request. This has to do with two requests that we got within a week from two different solar contractors for three building permits that we issued.
Mm-hmm.
The Municipal Association said that if we had no particular refund policy, then it's really kind of up to us, is my understanding. I don't,
right.
is how I read their guidance. And so, clearly the administrative fee should stand, and Tom did spend probably at least an hour in each of these, so we could consider refunding, I don't know what they were, but we could consider refunding all but, whatever time, let's say $100 of Tom's time plus the $25 fee.
I'm not interested in returning that bill.
Okay, Jody? Do you want to talk? Let's just check in. So, Mike, what?
Justify my response, Joe.
Yeah.
So, I see there's a cost of doing business. Just because you've decided in the end not to go forward with the project, there are steps that you have to take, and this is one of them. You know, if I came in for a building permit to build a shed in my non-existent backyard, and I decided not to, I would never in a million years think to come to the town and say, oh, just because I decided not to do something, I want a refund from your requirements that I freely entered into, you know? So that's just me.
Well, I mean, that was sort of my initial response too. He is like, hey,
not my fault. It's not the resident that are coming and asking, it's two different companies. I mean, that's just a company business. I mean, sorry.
They're not our residents, it's the contractor.
They're for substantial amounts, so, yeah.
Can I take a peek at them when you're done?
I didn't even see one.
It just says the permit numbers.
I mean, it's, you know, we don't understand, we have no way of knowing the relationship that these companies have with the homeowners and how well that they, you know, whether they came for these permits ahead of, you know, too much ahead of time, we don't know. All we know is that in good faith, we approve these building permits as part of how we're doing business. So, the most, so I'm actually, I would be okay with Michael's position. I would also be okay with a position where we think of refunding everything but $125, so I'm... Do you have a strong opinion one way or the other?
I do.
All right, Michael has the strongest opinion. I'm willing to go with Michael.
Sure, I guess I'll accept the strong opinion, but to me it's just the cost of doing business.
Yep.
Fair enough.
Okay. All right. Transfer station sticker request. I think that we're gonna find something in there. Jody, have you gone through it?
Yes.
So this is the case of a gentleman who is trying to sell a home on Kelwyn. And so he doesn't have New Hampshire plates. And so when I did, and I have to say I forgot all about this and it never made it to the agenda. But when I did talk to Kate about it, she wondered if we wanted to just do a temporary, like a
did reside there, that moved.
Yes, he did reside there. He's
still own the property,
right? So this letter is to temporarily allow Stephen Thayer of Kenwood Drive to dispose of trash recycling materials until April 6th, which is 4 weeks from now. So are we good with this?
Okay. Yes.
I will sign it then. Vehicle used to transport trash, I will have Kate fill that one out. Do you have a post-it?
I do.
Could you just make sure that she fills that out? Okay, thank you. Oh, this is a good one. Old highway shed. So I assume that the board received the same notification from our admin assistant that someone is wanting to buy the shed at the old highway shed. And so this sounds like a perfect public bid process. What do you think, Jody?
Yes, how do you want that? Do you want a minimum bid on that? Because they're dismantling it and moving it themselves. I don't know how much structurally sound it's gonna be once you dismantle it. So
all right, so how does that relate to whether or not we want to do, a public bid? What?
Well, I'm assuming it'll be a public bid, but do you want a minimum bid on it is my question.
I wouldn't even know what to put. I would say, though, that we would want to put that it is the responsibility of the buyer, successful buyer, to remove the
dismantle
and remove, and that it would require no resources of the town. Something like that, right? But
remove within 30 days? 30 days of acceptance?
30 days of acceptance. Unless, 30 days of acceptance. If they need to come to us, they can, right?
Unless
right.
Other arrangements can be made.
Right.
And they're not going to need a building permit.
No, we are exempt from that, so, whether it's...
Well, we don't charge for demolition.
That's right.
Oh, that's true. Okay, good. And what is your minimum bid?
I don't think I have a minute. I have no idea what this person has in mind.
Okay.
I have no idea how to value this. But if... So, one of two things will happen. The bid will come in and go, oh my God, that's super, yay, or bids. And the bid will come in and go, oh wow, that's really low. In which case, that may prompt us to look for some comparative. I just don't even know,
I don't know how big it is.
Are you fine with me getting comparative from the construction companies?
Yes.
And then I'll email you before.
Absolutely.
Send that. Well, you're gonna have to see the final draft before I send it out anyway.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not sure, we can always, we don't have to accept it, so I don't know why we have to have a minimum bid, but.
We don't know the lot number, do we? Unfortunately.
Because it only says town of Rollinsford on that.
Right, it's gonna have, because if we have the assessed value.
Oh, right, so for a public bid, we'll have to let people know where to look for.
Both the, you know, the land and the building.
Only NAFTEC.
I don't know whether.
I think it's 14 something.
Well, unfortunately, just on this page alone, there are, well, this one too. One, two, four, five, six, seven, eight that are in 14, so.
Five times we all come to get that map in one. Are you into one?
Charlie just sent us his suggested rules and procedures for town meetings, so. Just now, not that we'll have, you know, I don't want to necessarily, but yeah, we'll have to look at it next week. But I think he's willing to accept just individual responses and questions, I'm sure he is.
Okay.
Okay.
So do you want to get back to the prospective bidder and say?
We're gonna do a public bid, we'll ask Caroline to do that. So it's a question of how much time do we want to give? Maybe 2 weeks for something like this, where?
Okay.
Or what's the standard we've been using?
We've been using a week for vehicles, I think, is that?
A week or two, depending.
All right, so 2 weeks is reasonable.
So do you guys want to see the bid before?
No.
It goes out, okay. So we can close it out on, well, actually, we can give it 3 weeks, March 27th is a Monday.
Okay.
So we'll close it March 27th, open it March 27th.
Okay. Sounds good.
Because 1 week is the 13th, the 20th is 2 weeks, but it won't be written up till Wednesday.
Okay.
So that would be less than 2 weeks, and then it would be about 2.5 weeks that it would go.
All right, I think that's.
March 27th.
That's fine.
I guess I should ask the obvious question.
Yes.
Do we think it's a good idea to be selling this property? Not the property, but the building?
To sell it? Well, that's a very good question, Michael. Are you having some?
No, I'd love to get rid of it and not have to deal with the actual building, because it's just added cost. We want to develop that land somehow, but I would like to think things through. We're not missing anything, right?
Well, let's definitely be using it for storage or anything right now.
We emptied it out and.
Supposed to be, but that doesn't make.
It should be emptied. I think, I thought that everything was done.
You have Christmas decorations and things, right? They're all.
That's all gone.
Yeah. You know, he would be, you know, I could check with the department heads and see if there's any reason.
Just to make sure.
Yeah, I'd be happy to do that.
You want to do some of that?
Yep.
I mean, I'm just as happy to get rid of it, you know, and not have to deal with it.
See, the thing is.
Are there any implications too with that brownfield study that was going on?
No, is it, no.
Okay.
I can't think of any, I mean.
I can't either, but I thought, you know.
Yeah, because they're taking the metal, not the cement, because it's a cement slab with metal walls.
Yeah.
So they're taking the metal.
Yeah.
So.
I'm assuming they're leaving the cement slab.
Yeah, I would imagine.
So, you know, we're not using it. So it depreciates in value and in usefulness and worth with each passing day.
Yeah, no, but I thought, you know, we should have the conversation.
Yes, yeah, no, it's a good conversation to have. I think I had it myself in my head, but not necessarily with the board.
You must have talked about it.
Yes, publicly. Yes, so thank you for reminding us that. So, but I'll check with department heads and see if they have any.
Yeah, I think that's a good idea. Not to delay the process, but.
Well, hopefully we'll hear back from them within a day or so, so I can let them know. All right. All right, this is just a placeholder, the non-lapsing account for historical payment impact fees. We haven't heard from John Hinsman, he didn't come tonight. But it does remind me to put in the public record. Well, there are minutes, but we did meet with John Krebs last Thursday, the board. Mm-hmm. There were just two of us, Michael and me. And he is amenable to having a more expanded role. Help train and to form a technical review team with Tom Clark. And also, you know, to guide us on questions like impact fees or, you know, TIF districts or whatever things. And we also talked to him about what we can do to sort of energize and the economic activity and vitality of the district, the village district. That also came up with John. So, you know, we're getting some people kind of thinking about this. So that's just kind of a little synergy there. Policies and procedures, nothing. It's tabled. So I think we're on to board member activities and updates. So that note is just there to say that we did meet with Stratford Regional Planning this morning. We've already given an update on that. And what is going on in board members' lives this coming week? Is ballot testing going on tomorrow?
Tomorrow, yeah.
Our town clerk is managing. There's the public bid that we're opening at 11.
Yeah.
I think they're both going on at the same time, the ballot testing and the public bids.
Candidate thing tomorrow night, too.
There's the meet and greet tomorrow night at 6 o'clock at the library. Yeah, very good.
And rec meeting is the 12th at 7 o'clock.
Are you still meeting every other Sunday?
Every other Sunday, yeah.
That's amazing. So, would you forward those the job description things on to them?
I just did. Yeah.
Okay.
So
I didn't spend much time. So I started with the counselor. I started with the counselor, and I went to the assistant director, and then the director. A lot of the comments were going to be the same thing, so I sort of stopped and, you know.
Yeah. I re-forwarded
okay.
it to myself,
okay.
secretary, and the two chairs.
All right. Excellent. But great to have. Wonderful thing to have. So.
Oh, we also fixed Facebook. So I'm an administrator on the basketball Facebook page and the rec committee Facebook page. Anyone of you on the town Facebook page yet?
No, but I did check with Tia, and there's no, people don't post there. So there's no posting that has to be looked at. And it's just a regurgitation of what gets posted to the town website.
Okay.
So we should be fine in that regard. But something
at some point you're gonna want a password, because now we have a Twitter account that no one remembers the password for.
I don't know if we need a Twitter account personally.
Well, Patrick likes to tweet.
There's enough tweeting going on a little bit.
Well, Patrick has started a Twitter account.
I can get Patrick to just eliminate the Twitter account.
Well, I asked him, he couldn't remember the password. But he might remember it by now. It's been a while.
So can't, well, we'll see. I mean, I don't know how one gets deactivates a Twitter account, but
I'm sure he'd be able to.
Yeah. It seems to me that one should be able to do it even without the password, but we'll see.
I think there's a little button that says forgot password.
Probably.
All right.
I gave up.
Is that, we could start on the rec committee again. So I think we're good, and we can now go to building permits and correspondence?
Sure.
All right.
I don't have any.
You don't have any?
Well, for some reason, there's a couple of POs. I'll take that one.
Oh, okay.
First
I got POs in my box.
No, they're everywhere, aren't they?
Two from the town clerk. One versus town clerk tax collector. Purchase order number 1145 to the U.S. Postal Service. 10 rolls of stamps, $490.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
This one's urgent, apparently. I'll move it for discussion purposes only. Purchase order number 1179 to Inclusion Solutions, as submitted by the town clerk for one Franklin booth for $749, and then if we want, apparently, there's a note in the back, trade show model standing for notices. Apparently, I'll wait till the second.
Second?
Second.
Okay, so Michael, what?
The town clerk would like to buy a new voting booth.
Well, she wanted the, she told him wanting, she said this in the night.
She did, yes.
So this would, it would replace the tent, the, I mean, the, not tent, the,
Yes, it is.
The accessible voting tent.
Right, so this would have where one could only have one vote, voter, this would replace it with a station with up to four, one of which would be accessible to wheelchairs.
Right.
So it's on the budget, this is part of the budget that we put together. The question is whether we want to do this now, because we're about to have our only vote of this year.
Correct.
To, you know, to encourage a better flow of people through the.
So there's, which I think is admirable, that's wonderful, but the HAVA machine, the Help America Road Act, the little machine that we have in the.
Yes.
That helped several people in the last few elections vote.
Mm-hmm.
Is not going to be able to, is not gonna work.
So there's something with that?
Yeah, there's a whole big.
Inside the tent
is the whole system that we, now, granted, it's not the giant fax machine that it used to be, it's almost like an iPad now.
So there's no.
But there's no real sense of privacy there, and you have to, I mean, when I had to go in and help people vote, either filling out their paper ballot or using this machine, you know, you have to have a conversation with them, albeit very quietly. You have to talk to these people. It's going to be very difficult to have this conversation on this three other people around you, you know, trying to vote. It's just not, it's not practical.
I see.
For those needing assistance with voting.
Okay. All right.
I mean, I made it work, like, on presidential primary day, there were a few folks that needed assistance voting in the primary that used the little tabletop ones, and we made that work. I mean, it was different. It was at the end of the night, and they were the last two of the.
So there's no, there's no other place to put another voting booth then.
Not like that. I mean.
Well, according to this, you can buy the curtains that go with it. For another $1,000. It's New Hampshire size curtains.
Yeah.
Meets New Hampshire voting booth requirements. So they're labeled New Hampshire curtains.
We have our own special curtains.
The curtains would go around the booth.
Yeah. Well, all right, so we have questions, it sounds like, right?
I mean, there are questions, but there's also an outstanding $56,000 reduction in our, potential reduction in our budget.
Right.
After town meeting.
Yeah.
So is this particular voting booth a priority when we already have one that is
well, that's a good question.
Use?
That's a,
I mean,
that's an excellent question. It, you know, it
we have to look at a fax machine too.
Pardon me?
They want a fax machine. A new printer machine too, but they're starting to overheat.
Well, but those are two different functions. I mean, one is the franchise and the vote.
Right,
right.
The only other argument you could make for arguing against myself, but by statute, we're supposed to have X amount of booths for X amount of voters, and we're not in compliance.
We're not in compliance.
So, I mean, that this will assist with that, but I don't. But we're still going to need the idea that we're going to get rid of this booth giant tent that we have in the corner isn't going to work. I mean, I'm for getting something like that to extend. The number of booths, but if we're going to do that, we could just put a table in the middle and have, I mean, you could still fit everyone in this room and have the tabletop things. I mean, it's just going to be a narrower aisle, that's all.
Mm-hmm.
so.
All right, so it's, I mean, it sounds like we're just not ready to make a.
Next year, we don't have to have a hearing, I mean.
All right, well, if we're not ready, we're not ready, and that, that's okay.
I would just put a post-it note that, you know, would say, you know, due to, potential budgetary questions, we really don't want to take this on until after town meeting, I mean, it's just gonna. And whichever one of us sees a town clerk first, try to have a conversation with her, explain to her why we're not.
But you're gonna mix everything wrong.
Why we're not able to move forward right now.
Always the budget committee. That's what they're saying.
Yeah.
Polls, which would be great, and.
If you read Facebook, that's what they're saying.
Right, right, exactly, and I think if that's, the route we want to take in the future, I think we should do something like that. At least, you know, we could, should have that definitely for at least the presidential election.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, this, that standalone poll thing.
Yeah.
That makes a heck of a lot of sense, but right, I mean, we can.
Okay.
We took them up, but we may, we can manage here, so.
Okay, so we had a motion, so I will say all those in favor say aye.
I can withdraw my motion.
Wait a minute, wait a minute.
I'll just withdraw my motion. You don't have to.
You withdraw your motion? Okay, the motion's been withdrawn. Okay.
I think that one.
All right. So what, is that it in your folder, Michael?
No, sorry. And, other than just advisory, it's a copy for select board, that's the, investment, policy for the, trust and capital reserve fund from, help me, what they're called, trust for the trust fund. It just shows the accounts, where they're invested, what interest they're bearing, blah, blah, all that sort of stuff. If anyone wants to take a gander at it, I know it's on paper, but there should be something right up your alley.
There ain't no big interest going on anywhere.
No, there is not. When I was treasurer.
I remember, you looked, you looked.
Certain people would get very angry, but why aren't you making money? They used to make money, I'm like, well, because I don't set the interest rates and they're not paying anything right now. I can't, well, put it into what is it, CDs, like, well, the CDs are paying less than what you're making, you're gonna tie in.
Yes.
The fees associated with the CDs cost more than you would make in interest.
All right, you have purchase orders too.
I do, I think there's two in here. One is purchase order 932 to Chadwick Bayross, to fix electrical issues with the backhoe slash transmission.
That's the one I think we're holding off on, right, because we're gonna.
Yes.
That's the one that Jeff mentioned to us today.
Like $500, right?
Yeah, that's what I thought.
Did you copy them? Oh, did he have another one?
Yeah, so, all right.
Hold off till after town meeting and conversation with legal counsel, right?
Yeah, that's what we decided to do.
Unless that, Jody, check the corresponding documentation with it and make sure it's still 227, because if not, we don't want to, we only have 30 days to pay it, so. If not, there's interest is charged, you said.
Shipping date 227, service charge. Did you hand it to me and I just put it in my file?
Maybe.
Okay.
That's quite possible. Quite possible, that's what happened.
Legal slash town. Yeah, well, good. All right, so we have a letter for water discharge at 414 Boundary Street.
All right, so this is the house that, Jeff sent us the picture of, and it refers to ordinance 1501. So is the board good with my signing this, letter?
I have twice today.
Water's being discharged on the property 414 Boundary Street.
I want to look at the picture again, I mean, there is definitely water being discharged. But it all looked like, well, the two times I drove by, at 10 in the morning, or a little before that, after I left the meeting this morning, like doing stuff here, it was about 10. And then on the way over tonight, it was all in the sort of the ditch lines, so I don't.
Do you want to talk to Jeff about it?
It didn't look like it, I forgot all about it when he was here.
Well, we can put this in the folder and talk to Jeff.
Let me just look at the picture again, maybe it, I mean, it could have been going across the street, earlier, but Okay, yeah, so.
Into the street, not across.
Into the street. So when I went and looked, I don't know when he took this picture, let's see. Okay, well, he sent it at 10:17, but maybe I went earlier. What time did our meeting end?
9.
I thought it went earlier, but it wasn't this severe when I, it was all just contained into the, onto the grassy area. It wasn't, but I mean, this picture doesn't lie. It is certainly going across the, into the road. It didn't look this severe then. But you, clearly they've got a pipe where they're.
Yeah, there's the pipe and this is it going into the road.
But the pipe isn't the road.
Not even close to it, so that's, I mean,
it's
a whole other issue.
Does that make a difference? How does that make a difference? If the water, if water is coming from the.
Well, the idea that it's supposed to be, you know, percolating through the ground, obviously it's frozen, so nothing's getting in. So, yeah, we should send it, that's fine. I just wanted to draw our attention to the fact that it wasn't, it could have been the sun got to it all day. I mean, I don't know. It was not this severe.
I will ask the question again.
Yes, sign it.
Board okay with me signing it?
Sure.
As the chief troublemaker brought it up.
We will see them if they don't like this.
Yes, sure we will.
We will see them.
It's an apartment building. It's not, I don't think it's a municipal residence.
Well, it's a couple.
Maybe. Well, that could be a big apartment building.
This is a response from the New Hampshire Retirement System. And they approved our, I guess, appeal of not paying a late money, a late assessment.
Yes, that was the time that, yeah,
so,
Caroline with weather and holiday and stuff.
Holiday.
So, good news.
Snowstorm.
Thank you, Retirement System.
Thank you.
This is purchase order 1125 to Duvet's Portable Welding and Fabrication under Town Hall Maintenance for altering rails on front steps to meet fire code.
Did you talk to us about this?
Yes, last week.
Talk to who?
You did. You decided that you're going to wait until after town meeting.
Yeah, I would like, you know.
Did you have a conversation with Richard yet?
No, I had a conversation with Richard.
I understand
ago,
that, but we were
going
to see if we could catch up with him to see what he was planning.
Right. I personally would like to know exactly what is going to happen,
yes,
and what it looks like, is what I don't want is to create a different mess.
Yeah, I agree with you 100%.
You know, and so I don't really understand what's going to happen. And I did ask Caroline this morning if she wanted to have Richard talk to you or to Jody, because
it's too bad he wasn't in this morning.
Yeah, he wasn't in today, so I don't know exactly what the plan is, and I prefer to know what the plan is.
No argument.
So
yeah, storming looks like.
And Caroline was trying,
So we'll talk to Richard?
Yes.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm happy to have him talk to either one or both, you know, or one of us.
Right, just
but
so that one of us knows.
One of us has an idea of what it is and can explain it to the rest of us. But I know that the joint loss or the audit, the fire department audit, I mean, I know that it's not a good thing. But I don't want to replace a not good thing with another not good thing.
I agree with you.
Well,
so,
the steps are already not in compliance.
That whole entrance, yes, the whole entrance is difficult and challenging.
That monstrosity of a ramp up for it one time, too.
Oh,
awful.
Yeah, there was that. I do remember that vaguely.
This is from the rec department from Kelly. Apparently she didn't know she needed a purchase order. But it's for 10 passes to the New Hampshire State Parks bus pass program for a total of $235. And what they're going to do with the, if you buy these bus passes ahead of time, you get a discounted rate to go to all the different parks along the way. And part of our, Tuesday's field trips are going to be some state parks.
Oh.
Excellent.
So
is that in your budget?
And Ryan and
okay,
Castle,
so yeah, just have either you could do a purchase order or, I mean, that would be simple. It sounds like the board is amenable to doing this. It's part of their budget. So we should wait though till after. Can we wait till after town meeting?
Sure.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, there's no.
Okay.
By them.
Just be best, because it would be the most prudent, I think, to wait. But they can, in the meantime, fill out the purchase order.
Okay. Purchase order 1146 to Municipal Management Association of New Hampshire for annual dues of $50.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
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 This is a purchase order 719 to Bobcat of New Hampshire for hydraulic motor for the sweeper for $1,174.
Yeah, we're holding off until October.
And this is an October bill, though.
It's a quote, it's not a bill. It shouldn't be a bill. This was, this is something that
I missed all the way.
Jeff spoke to us about it in the fall, and he said and we said, wait till the end of the year, and then, I don't know, we didn't address it.
We did, and then,
we
still fell away, so.
The estimate already expired, February
4th, 2017. So anyway, we said, wait till after town meeting, so that's why it's in there. We're waiting till after town meeting.
Okay.
He came back with it last week, I think.
Mm-hmm.
And so we didn't have post-its because we were at the school.
What you do with that one?
The post-its.
Okay.
Is that the
State
survey?
Of New Hampshire Department of Transportation. Bureau of Planning Assessment. DOTs, that's specific data. This is our road audit on streets and byways.
Oh, the ones that are ours? That we get our money back from? Is that what it is?
It's like a Christmas present.
Are they asking us to confirm? What are they asking? I don't know what that's supposed to be. Road name changes. What's one of the roads we changed? Was it around Kelwyn?
Mm-hmm.
Spruce
yes.
to Spruce? Can you see if that's been done? Where's Kelwyn? Indian Brook. Kelwyn. So
that would be this street right here.
This one right here. So but they didn't do that, right?
Cedar something.
Is that the one? Yeah. Cedar something. And what was the other one? Old Rawl?
Old, a little jug handle there on Old
Old Rawlinsford Road or Old Portland Ave?
Portland Ave, yeah.
So where's Portland?
Would be on the side of
this side.
Silver,
Roberts, and here's Route 4, so it is
Post Road or something.
Would be this, and I don't remember what name it got.
What is it now?
Well, it used to be Old Portland Ave or something like that.
I think it was Old Post.
Is that the name?
I don't remember. To be honest with you, I could tell.
When the new book comes out, we'll be able to tell.
I can tell you it's on the warrant, so let's see. The last just I thought I'd never bring my own last week.
There's only
but they
one
didn't
that
on the pass, I think.
Only one, that was Silver Lane. Because, what's her name there?
Right.
This is Leda, now lives in Massachusetts. Most of the year. Road name change, pass, Cedar Lane was Kelwin Drive. To see if the town will vote to change the name of the dead-end section of Kelwin Drive to Cedar Lane. It was supposed to be Ricker Hill Road, and the residents did not like that.
No, because there was no hill around.
There's no hill there, no.
As I recall.
It's a flat little spot.
Crazy, huh?
So this map gives us reference nodes with numbers on them.
Okay, so we would just, well, I think we could have Caroline maybe put this together for us, and then we could sign it.
The jug handle there?
Old street name, yeah, so one was, was it Kelwin?
Went from the dead-end section of Kelwin Drive, is now Cedar Lane. And... the old section of Portland Avenue is all it says here.
Old Portland Avenue?
Old Portland Avenue is now Toll Road.
Well, as long as we've got the map, we might as well, what's the begin node of Kelwin Drive, Bethel? Can you find that?
Oh, yes, sorry.
Or the old Portland Ave, whichever one you come across first.
The node for Kelwin is 6138.
Okay, and is there an ending node?
Yeah, but it's so tiny you can't read it.
And it's in a crazy color.
It's a red dot over red numbers.
That's helpful.
Get my loops.
Oh.
Really?
Okay, good.
Yeah.
It was
a bad
one.
Evil eyes.
I'm not sure that it's 6138 here. It almost looks like 6138.
Which node am I looking for? Where is it? Where am I looking for? Where is... Which one?
That one.
That one looks like 6. I got double duty here.
I need the begin node and the end node.
6138. Either 6 or 8. There's a line through it, so it's...
Okay. 8, well, let's go with 8. Do you have an end node?
I think it is 8, actually.
Okay.
End node would be 317, I believe.
Okay. Now, can you find Portland Ave, old Portland Ave?
If I turn it that way. Good one. Portland Avenue, yes.
A little
I don't
right
even
here.
Need the thing for that.
All right. I need a begin and an end.
Well, that's what
I don't care too much. Just give me
18.
One first. 18.
And what do you think is next?
19.
That one I
could
see.
All right, so that's it for this, I think. Tom Rollinsford.
That's pretty cool sounding.
Ms.
Yes.
Agent name. I guess that's me. I will decide.
How's it easy?
I need it sometimes to...
Especially if you don't have your glasses.
I can't see that good on the side.
Okay. Let's see if that's all we have to do.
We have to make sure that this is updated after town meeting. And if we've received any federal aid, which we have not.
Not yet.
As well.
It's a loan aid. Aid is not a good thing.
Yeah. I don't know if I can see what it's a date. Excuse me, probably going to the next year, actually.
So the other thing is, where's the whole inventory, though? Was it? There was nothing else?
One of those spiral-bound books.
Oh,
they're doing it?
I'm just, I mean, is this the time where they tell us, you know, who gets the money for Oak Street?
This is the New Hampshire Coastal Risk.
Okay.
Bottom report of coastal risk. This is the sea rise.
So, did the town take action to reclassify, rename, accept or discontinue any class four, class five roads? And the answer is yes, we did rename, right? Okay.
From the sea rise level, we didn't even make the pie chart to get a name.
Wrong
such a slogan.
Yeah, we're not, it's really.
Danger. We're not in danger as much as all the others.
Hampton, for example.
Right, Hampton's the half the pie. So that's easy reading, like we're doing for you.
All right, light reading, thank you.
So this you want to.
This get back to Kim, I think we can, I signed it. Part of it I signed. I signed this part.
Right.
I guess we have to save that after town meeting.
Okay. Administrative office from New Hampshire Employment Security. Occupation employment report. Are you sure? Thank you. I'm going to go to the ESR office. I should complete the occupational employment report. If you have already returned it, thank you. This report is mandatory under our legal.
What's the report?
Economic and labor market information.
And we're compelled to fill it out?
How many employees fill in part-time? Instructions for reporting occupation. Reporting wages.
Is it just our employees? Here, I'll just put a note. I'll do it with Caroline at some point.
I thought that was optional last year. Change that.
It's mandatory. Dear New Hampshire employer, I guess, yeah, it's from Employment Security.
Yes.
ES.
It used to be just the Department of Employment Security. Now they're going by NHES, sorry.
Mm-hmm.
This is your OEP for the transfer station. You have two
copies
of it.
Okay, good. So we have to ask for intergovernmental review. That doesn't say anything. It just says your request is assigned a number.
Oh.
A summary of the results will be issued upon completion of the review process on or before the suspense date, which is the 8th.
March.
So they're just March.
And
so they're just telling us that we have a number and somebody's looking at it. So apparently they've asked people to review our applications for the culvert project. I had to do another whole application process to these folks.
Yeah.
All right. So this isn't the result necessarily.
Nope.
Just telling us that they've received it. Okay. We don't have to do it for the fire engine, by the way, if we want. Okay. So that's just
that
a notice, just
with
file. Yeah, file with bond warrants. Is what it's meant to talk about.
Public hearing from Health Trust on July rates, March 9th at 10 a.m. in Woodstock, also March 9th at 5 p.m. in Concord.
Thank
if anyone is interested.
I think I'm passed, thank you.
Enel is moving. This letter is informing that Enel, Green Power North America Inc. in Andover, Mass. is moving locations effective February 17th. The address is still Andover, Mass. The new address.
Okay.
Our telephone number will remain the same.
All right, pretty good. Ms. Pilot.
Okay, Department of Safety. City of New Hampshire, Nevada networks are proposing the delivery of LTE network and 700 megawatts band that is specifically designed for public safety. The 2012 Middle Class Tax Relief and Job Creation Act made this possible. Is this something for the chief?
Chairman of the Board of Selectmen.
I know. This proposed network is being purposely built for New Hampshire's police officers, firefighters, emergency medical technicians, and other frontline officers. However, it will not only power the public safety mission, but the platform is innovation and economic development. So,
is this an FYI? Are they asking us to do something?
Stakeholders, area, existing infrastructure, create new infrastructure. Appreciate your continued cooperation, looking forward to working. I hope the chief got a copy of it. Both chiefs got a copy of that. But it sounds like that goes right under with their changing their, which we just signed the budget vote for tonight.
Well, that was one aspect, but there's the warrant article. Yeah, let's make sure that Ducharme gets a copy of that.
Infinity sent us more mail. They no longer carry Esquire. Comcast sent us overnight delivery commitments, a renewal process. In triplicate? But this is dated February 15th. Here's a copy.
Well, we can see if we want to submit this to our legal counsel. So why don't, are there enough copies for us to?
Pardon? Are you joking?
No. I mean, you know, we're operating under the 1972 agreement that we just keep extending. So now they're actually, I think they're going to want us to do a renewal.
Mm-hmm.
So we should probably, we will need some.
Within 6 months of submission.
Some legal advice. So let's make sure this is on the agenda for next week. So we can talk about whether we want to pass this on to Steve.
Sent us the digital packages preferred, so, in case you're interested in that. HBO, Showtime, Townsend Energy sent us a proposal that is addressed to Jeff. Installation of wall furnace. Is that for
the new building?
Is that for his building? For his building or the new shed to go into the warming hut?
I don't know, you didn't mention it.
It's
$1,400, so that's not for the highway. Might be the little.
No shit.
Yeah, it is, Jesse, well, oh yeah, yeah. Well, let's talk to her about it. I don't know what it is.
Is that me? Oh. No, that's fine, I just remember turning mine on, I'm like, I don't know that beep. York Ambulance.
Oh, all right, I have some information on this. So this is the contract that we wanted Mark to look at, and Caroline said, I asked her, well, if it's exactly like the one we've had, then we're fine because Mark has reviewed it. So she looked at it, other than the dates, the applicable dates, she did find one place where a notice of something had to take place, and they were gonna send those notices to, I don't know, whatever it was, and said they really should come to the board. So that's what they changed in the contract. So that contract is exactly the same as last year's. The notification of emergency, whatever, is going to come to us. Otherwise, it's the same contract. Yeah.
So, yeah, contracts were $64,000, $32,000 each year.
Yeah. So I will entertain a motion from the board to sign this contract.
So moved.
Okay. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
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 Bottom of the pile, this is from last week. This is the water district, the variable form for them to do.
So when we first looked at it, we weren't even sure that it was from the water district. So it is the water district, and I asked Caroline, does this meet, you know, our
right.
blah, blah, blah. She says, yes, it does. They would have to.
And then we have their coverage.
Yeah,
people as well.
So, if the, so yeah, is there some? Okay, so we'll sign this.
And what is that?
It's a permit to obstruct. So we have a new ordinance now that we developed last year, which, so when people, contractors or whatever, have to cut into our streets, they have to apply for a permit. So we went to visit the water district to say, you know, this pertains to you as well. And so they said they didn't want to have to come to us for every time they do it, but would do it like for a year at a time. So, so this is for 2017. It's a license for them to do whatever construction they need to do in the roads, but it also causes them to make sure that they repair the roads according to the ordinance and those kinds of things. So I will be signing it. So we'll extend it to December 31st, right, of this year.
Weren't you going to talk about the transfer station in the DES request?
Transfer station.
Yes.
That never made it to the agenda. You're talking about the old?
We had a form for Jeff. We said, oh, don't forget, we have.
Yeah, I thought it was. Mm-hmm. I thought that's what it was, but it was
the old. It was the old transfer station. The old dump.
The old landfills.
The
old landfills. So.
Is form out in there?
No, there was no form in there.
Yeah.
I thought it was, but it wasn't.
So I think
she
it's
sent
a.
Sent it to me.
Yeah.
She sent an email to me?
To
all
of us.
I was here when the phone call came.
Oh, so anyway, I guess it's a complicated process. Do we want to Do you know if there was a date by which we had to attend to the settlement? Can we table it so that we can look at it, because I haven't looked at it?
Oh, yes, there is a date, March 31st.
Okay, we have time.
We have time.
I think, I don't know what's expected of us, I haven't seen it.
Plenty of time.
For us, that's plenty of time, yeah, so.
Unless you wanna take the time to read it tonight.
No, I do have questions, though, where is this landfill?
I think it's asking us, do we have any?
I thought it was at the transfer station, did they used to use the transfer station as a landfill?
Yes, there's that, and then there's Sandy Bank.
It was closed.
And we used to use Sandy Bank as a landfill.
Mm-hmm.
Where's Sandy Bank?
Between Locust and Foundry, where the.
Which is the baseball field you were talking about this morning?
Right.
And when did that close?
No clue.
Okay.
I think Ed said in the thirties.
No clue.
Oh, in the thirties.
Is that true?
That's what Ed told me.
But we used to use the transfer station.
As a landfill.
As a landfill till when?
I'd say in the eighties.
Well, we started the transfer station in 1990s, in the early nineties, so there's probably a relationship between closing of one and the start of the other.
Because none of that has ever been mentioned at my Lamprey meetings. So, 'cause we pay for the closure of the Summersworth landfill.
Summersworth or Lamp, the one at Durham? Is it Summersworth, is that what it is?
Summersworth.
See, I don't know, I don't know, I don't know where we're supposed to.
Yeah, 'cause we took our municipal garbage there after.
I see.
So, but nothing's ever been said about our landfill, and I'm like.
Yeah, I don't know what they want, 'cause I haven't read it, but I know Caroline says, Caroline is sort of going like this.
The map that was associated with the email that came out, it's where, I'm reading the map correctly, where the compactors are now, that whole area.
Behind?
Behind there, yeah. It's where it's indicated on that map, I don't know if that's true or not.
They need to have soil samples?
Yes, and the testing for all this stuff.
So the retaining wall is the landfill?
Part of it, I think.
Oh.
And one of the things, there's something about the concrete pads.
Well, I know we don't have them, we're trying to put them.
Yeah.
Trying to get them.
Yeah, they wanted to send it.
So.
So the landfill is right where we drive up, or was?
The whole area opens.
The map.
When did she send this?
That'll be interesting to look at.
When did she send this, Selma?
I think it came on Friday morning, wasn't it?
Yep, Friday morning, and.
Which was what day?
March 3rd, at 1:01 PM.
Yeah.
Oh, here's a rear real quick.
I don't have.
Hi, it appears that we may have a new news to us. Reporting compliance obligation, I received an email from Kate that she received from DES regarding a six-page report we're supposed to be filling out annually by March 31st regarding an inactive landfill. It's a comprehensive report asking about results of testing and inspections. Rollinsford has never filed this report. Ever, apparently. I called DES and spoke with Linda Birmingham. I forwarded to her a follow-up email that she sent to me after she spoke, we spoke about it. She was going to speak with the department regarding what we should be doing with regard to monitoring, testing, and inspections. You'll notice that there is something in the email about towns with small populations that are exempt. This doesn't apply to us. Also, 1981 is a critical year with regard to landfills. If we did not accept waste after 1981, it reduces or limits our obligations. We did. She says that it has appears that we did, but it's not exactly conclusive. Well, I remember the landfill as a little kid, but I couldn't tell you exactly where it was. There's a lot left to be understood, and no doubt, about the situation, but in the meantime, we're left with a report to file. Attachments. And then there's some interaction between the Department of Environmental Services and Caroline. But if you look at the map.
So she said she'd keep us informed.
Look at the map. That'd be a lot bigger on your laptop than my little phone here. And then there's notices from when we closed the landfill. I don't want anyone to be shocked, but apparently
that we kept up with reporting what the department wanted. Now you're all shocked. So, it actually, you know what, it appears it's behind where the so there's the metal pile, right, when you drive into the right, brush pile.
Where do you see this map?
That's attached to a hand-drawn map.
What was the name of the?
The file is
IIS proxy?
Proxy, yes. But if you look, well, you're gonna pull it up yourself in a second.
Oh, yeah.
It's a hand-drawn map.
Yeah, I see that.
But then there's a topographical.
Yeah.
And then there's another hand-drawn, God, it's on like a lined piece of paper.
Yeah. 1986.
And so, where it says existing ash, that's, I did a little digging. No pun intended. It just means municipal waste.
But since this picture, we've moved tires and brush and metal all around, so.
Yeah, the metal pile is still consistent, right?
Mm-hmm.
From where we came in, so. Yeah, this map is, we believe, where the access road is here, going in. Metal pile's there. So it's either right where the compactors are now, or slightly behind it.
It's gonna be where you put all your where people pick up all that mulch.
Probably. I said, the letter is interesting. On March 9th, 1987, I met with, this is a letter from Steve Cullinane from DES. Well, I think they were called something different then, but anyways. He met with, this is who he met with at the transfer station. Dick Rugg from Landry Co-op, Ed Jansen, Board of Selectmen, Bob Shagan, Rollinsford R.A., road agent.
It says that the trick, I'm sorry.
Norm Leclerc from the Summers Road DPW, I don't know why. Someone from Kimball Chase. Someone from CEH. No, CEH, that's what it
is. In this email from Linda Birmingham, one of the emails anyway, it says that the transfer station has filed annual reports. The last one was in 2015. So,
do we have a copy of that one that we filed? Did she send that to us? I don't see it here.
I don't know.
I see things from 1992. Maybe 7.
The transfer station has filed annual reports. The last one was in 2015.
So there's one. Notice of intent for the town of Rollinsford regarding law changes in the statutes in 2003 regarding solid waste.
Susan, there's an annual report that does get filed about.
Is that what she's referring to?
I would think so.
Yeah,
I'm doing the one for 2016 right now.
Oh, okay.
So that much I know we do. But we haven't filed these reports regarding the
Closure.
But I know we do, we do our yearly recycling, all that stuff. We're in garbage before the last time. Number 1993. But we're not going to figure it out tonight, right?
Right. So
it's on our radar now.
We can ask Caroline what the status is of this, because it sounded like this Linda Birmingham was going to be checking with her supervisor, blah, blah, blah. So, I mean, we've never been filing this particular kind of report, I mean, my first question would be to try to figure out, can we continue not to fill up, can we continue not to do this? All right, well, thank you for bringing that up, because it never made it to the agenda, clearly.
Yeah.
I'm gonna pay a note of that, so that.
Well, it's not a big deal.
It is.
You'd be very excited to know this. I forgot to mention this under board activities. Planning board's meeting tomorrow night to discuss modifications to the Rollinsford site plan and subdivision regulations in regard to revised stormwater regulations.
Yay.
That's all I'm thinking about.
Okay, all right, I'll try to follow up with it. Plan for things. The other thing that I need to mention to the board is that, you know, we said that we would have Caroline work on easements with regard to the culvert.
Yeah.
So she will be doing some of that stuff, so just letting you know that she'll be contacting people and et cetera, et cetera, so.
So are we, I'm assuming we're gonna do it next week now because we don't have the town report yet, but we need to divvy up the warrant articles. Who's gonna discuss them?
Yes. Yeah, we could, yeah, it's a little late to do it tonight.
Make sure we get it on the.
Yeah, yes.
Get it on the agenda for next week.
Yeah, actually, I did want to do it tonight, but, well, we can. It's kind of late.
Nice to have the copy of the warrant for us.
Well, I have it.
I'm working on it.
I have it.
I'm going to book.
It could just be printed. I want to make notes, so.
I'll have to bring it next week.
Prepare to do it tonight. It's almost all, I just, I didn't get it until.
Okay, so, are we done? Okay, community input? Yes, Nancy.
I kind of take exception to the fact that you didn't have time for the SB2 because we put it in on the day that we were by law able to put it in by.
Oh, absolutely, it's the public hearing. It was the timing of the public hearing and when we had to get materials into, you know, to the printers and stuff. Not the actual petition. The petition arrived in time, absolutely. Celia, did you?
In regards to replacing the booth for voting, I know it's a handicap booth, but it comes in handy also as a benefit to people who bring their children. And I think teaching children to vote is a very, setting an example and getting them exposed to the whole political system is important. And I bring my children with me when I vote. And oftentimes I wait or am sent down to the large booth, tent booth at the end, so that my kids can start learning the process.
Mm-hmm. So that's another rationale then for.
So that's part of the reason. I can understand getting a smaller booth, but right now, I would suggest keeping the other one.
Well, the board didn't accept the purchase order, so I think we're good to go for another time. Salma, were you trying to?
Yes, I was. We didn't talk about the signs for town meeting.
I thought the board had approved them when I wasn't.
They're here.
Yes. Okay, so.
They're in this building. When are they going out? How are they going out?
Got it. When we've done sandwich boards in the past, who has put them out?
I have, with help.
Can you do it again with help or not? Would you like us to have a different solution? You can say yes.
Well, no, I mean, a different solution would be the best, of course. But, you know, if I'm left doing it, I will, but I will not do it alone.
So how many do we have?
We have 12 signs, so enough for six.
We don't have six sandwich boards?
No, but the school will lend us.
Oh, okay, so we have six, okay.
So that's not a problem.
Do we need to figure out where we want them?
Yeah, we do.
So do we usually put one right out here, town hall?
Yes.
All right. By the overpass?
Yeah.
The traffic island there?
Traffic island. And then.
There's one that's split in two.
Yeah, I remember, half right away.
So that one, really, you could put it on the cemetery fence. and then over by Janko.
I really hate anything on cemetery grounds. I think that is so disrespectful.
Okay.
Yeah, that's probably a good point.
It's the, a telephone pole, I don't care.
So.
Cemetery fence is very sacred, so I really hate anything on a cemetery grounds.
There's a big, nobody's right behind it.
No, it's just the fact that it's the cemetery.
It's not a problem.
So Morton Park though, I mean the little, right?
Yeah.
Something could be there.
Well, I thought you were putting one on the traffic island by there.
Yeah, well, we could have the one at Morton Park would, do you think it's redundant? All right, so we have six. Where do you want them? Town Hall, Traffic Island by the overpass.
The one. It's a Janko.
Janko is, so is that?
That's a single-sided one, I think.
One by corner of Rollins and Roberts Road. By the Grand Tall.
Portland.
Oh, Portland.
What did I say?
Yeah.
Portland, not Rollins.
By Garrison Players.
Yeah.
Yes. School on Bloom Street, maybe right, you know, in there, we have to check with them, but.
It has nothing to allow it.
Yeah.
Well, we're borrowing one of theirs, it'd be convenient to use that.
Transfer station. Transfer station.
Transfer station.
So that's it, right?
Yep. And when do you want them up for?
This weekend?
Oh my god.
And I can help us on that. Can you just?
So they're a week away. So one of the things that Jeff always says is that he's not asked to do it. He's told to put these signs up or help with the
booths?
Yeah. And it really isn't his job description. And so if we're going to ask him to do it, we really should ask him to do it instead of telling him to do it from.
Well, it should come from a select board, it shouldn't come from a town.
Yes, and so it's not coming from.
Are we talking about the, are we talking about the sandwich boards, or are we talking about the setup?
Both.
Because we're not asking to do the sandwich boards, I think Sally and Mike are doing.
I'll do it on Saturday, will you?
We will have to be careful about snow though, because if it snows and he needs to plow, we have to pull him up.
Yep.
So.
So you want to do it on Saturday?
Sure.
So what we need to do, maybe on Friday I'll go to the school. Now do the school ones probably have sand in them?
Mm-hmm. They're very heavy.
Yes, they are.
It takes two people to carry it.
Yeah.
So one stays at the school.
What?
So that one will stay at the school.
No, all of theirs.
All of them.
Yeah.
Right.
We have
our two-person lift.
What happened is they put the wrong order in, so we got two free ones.
Oh, that's nice.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So the setup here, the election setup.
Mm-hmm.
So I can ask him if he's willing to help with that, and copy Kate. I mean, is that?
I just think he should be asked, and I just felt that, because I do ask, I'm like, hey, when do you need me? And she's like, I'm all set. But I didn't realize she was all set with Jeff and the rest of the highway crew.
Okay.
So.
All right, I can ask him.
I just think it's more polite instead of.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh,
Oh, I'm sorry, yes.
I just have one question. If you're not putting them out till Saturday, are you giving enough time to the public?
Well, it's always, you know, you could do it too soon and then people stop looking at it and stop noticing it and, you know, so who knows? I mean, what do you think?
Usually, when we put all your other ones out for the budget committee, when we put the budget committee ones out, we did it 1 week prior.
Well, this is more than a week. This is Saturday, this coming Saturday is more than a week. Well, it's more than a week for the town meeting. It's a week for the town meeting.
You're only given 3 days for voting.
It has nothing to do with.
It doesn't say the voting, it says town meeting. It says the business. It's the Saturday piece, so.
So it doesn't have, you're not putting anything out for town vote?
At least we'll get people to see that. I mean, what happens sometimes is there's too much on these sandwich boards and you can't really see what's on them. So there's nothing, you know, no system is perfect. So this is what's happening right now, which is, you know, to the good. So we'll get them out this Saturday and we'll see what happens. Yes.
Would you consider in future years putting like town meeting voting Tuesday 7 to 7 and then business or then like
continuation
town meeting and the other date with the time? I know I just drove through Vermont and I saw them all along the roads because Saturday, Sunday and today are their town meetings.
Yes. So can we now adjourn, please?
Don't forget to sign your rec paperwork.
It'll be done by next meeting. How's that?
Sounds good.
Are we ready to adjourn, board?
Most ready.